Alrighty, Yar. So yeah, like I said, there's no shame in going down, and it just, you know. So thank you, Fuzzit, for that heads up. Yeah, there's some problems with this laptop. Yeah, my browser's frozen, and now the I can't read the live chat, so I'll have to rely on you, Varushka. I am blind on the other half, so it's okay. Go ahead. Continue that thought. Oh, and Rise was saying it was about 2002-ish.
Okay, 2002, yes. So, you know, this is quite a bit different now. And so I feel excited about the fact that we've grown in number. I mean, I don't think that people realize that it's sort of like, I guess, that 100th monkey concept. When something reaches critical mass, you know, the whole, and I think that what's great is that people are rallying behind something that is affecting, I mean, obviously you and I both know that fracking is affecting everybody, but I think that the whole evidence that we're seeing around us of extreme weather events, right, is that is affecting everybody, like obviously everyone, it's affecting everyone. And so that's something that is uniting people in such a way that they're showing up. And to have anybody show up to anything is already a miracle. You know what I mean? But to have 500,000 people completely, you know, stop traffic in New York is so great. It's such a great thing. And of course, there were events happening all around the world. So it wasn't just in New York. And I believe that the next event is going to be even bigger. So, and I went to the Flood Wall Street the next day, and that was awesome. I mean, really great to see people, you know, just passionate and alive and, you know, committed to the shift that is going to happen eventually. So is there a question? I think there's a question in the chat here. Let's see. Suppose it asks, how long has the Kickstarter been up? 4 days to go. Okay. And then do you think it'll happen? Yes, it will. Thoughts in motion. So yes, Buzzit, it's been up for 24 days, I guess it is, or 23 days, something like that. And so yes, we have 4 days to go, and we have raised $15,000 so far. But our goal is $25,000. And the interesting thing is that the last Kickstarter I did kind of came together at the last moment. We had that kind of a rallying sort of moment the last few days. So it looks like this is kind of going the same way. And I know we're going to get this. But what we need is we need everyone to jump in and just pledge whatever they can, even if it's a dollar. And that's what's great is that, in, you know, on these crowdfunding campaigns is that you can pledge a dollar even. And, you know, let's say, you know, for example, I have almost 5,000 friends on Facebook, you know, and if everybody on my Facebook just pledged $1, we'd have $5,000 right there. And, you know, it's not really a whole lot of money. I mean, people spend, you know, $10 on a coffee sometimes. You know, they go out and, you know, drink a cup of coffee out, you know, and out and about. And so $1 or even $10 is really not going to, you know, it's not a big amount, but it makes a huge difference to us. And the other part of that is that psychically and spiritually, that's what I mentioned in the first one, is that the thing I really love about it is this tapestry of energy from the people that have participated in funding something like this, a movie like this, which is more of a grassroots kind of a independent film about an important subject, right? That it's like we're so connected, and everyone that's involved in the funding or the helping of the funding of it is so connected. And that's the beauty of this. So it's like this energy, it's like everyone that pledges, it's like their energy is intricately connected to this project. And so anyway, that's what I love about crowdfunding.
And just on our archival note, I will be transferring all this to YouTube, and I'll tweet out the link. So if you want to add that to the Kickstarter page and anywhere else, you have a Facebook page for A Crack in Everything, the film. So if you're watching this on YouTube, and I'll put the links up in the info section, you know, below. And I'm blind here, so if you have any questions from the live chat, read them out.
Yes, let's see. Did I see? Okay, Fuzzit asks, did you see Russell Brand at Wall Street yesterday? Oh goodness, I really wanted to. I was actually invited by Daniel Pinchbeck, who's a friend of his, and I did really want to go. But unfortunately, I had to stay up here working very hard on this project. And I'm 2 hours away from New York City, so it's not always a perfect opportunity for me to just jump and go to these events that are happening now more frequently. And I think Russell Brand is great. I really appreciate that he's trying to, really stir things up in a good way, you know. I think what he's doing is great. So I wish I had seen him. But let's see. Any other questions? Let's see. Shapeshift Dream Productions. Yes. Fuzzit asks, is Shapeshift Dream Productions me? Yes, it is me. It's a company that I started. And the reference to Shapeshift Dream is actually, I did some work with John Perkins. Maybe some of the viewers may understand or know who he is. He wrote a book called Confessions of an Economic Hitman that was just a crazy success. And I think it was on the New York Times bestseller list 52 weeks, which is crazy. And it was never reviewed. John Perkins came out in this book, which is called Confessions of an Economic Hitman, coined the term economic hitman. He came to speak about his experiences as part of a team of people that were going around the world, two different countries, mainly underdeveloped countries. Ecuador, for example, would have been an example of a country that they went to, and to speak to the heads of state about the necessity for them to take American companies. Bring them to Ecuador, for example, and set up structures, that would involve very large corporations making a lot of money from the resources of that country. And I'm giving you Ecuador as an example because one of the things that happened was Chevron Texaco went in there they destroyed the whole natural habitat and environment of indigenous people that had been living there for generations and generations, and actually told them that it was okay to bathe in the oil, that it was actually good for their bones. And they didn't even, the people, and I don't remember the name of the tribe, but they didn't speak Spanish even. It was their own language that they had to actually be communicated in with from somebody who spoke their language and also spoke Spanish, because the representative of the company told the person who was talking to the people in the tribe that they should bathe in this oil. They didn't know. They don't watch television. They don't have, the luxuries of modern whatever so-called civilization. So they didn't. They just believed what these people were telling them. And so that's a criminal act, and in my opinion, I think that they basically murdered people. Anyway, these are the kinds of things that John Perkins in his book, he doesn't talk about that specifically, but it's a fantastic book and everyone should read it. He was very brave in coming forward and telling the story. And of course he's slightly, he writes beautifully. I mean, it reads like, you can't put it down. It's totally almost a thriller. You have to keep reading it from the beginning to the end. So anyway, I spent some time with John because he did not only wrote that book, and he's written some other books about the whole concept of, you know, what an economic hitman is and our involvement in other countries' resources. But he also works with indigenous people and has a strong connection with the Quechua. I believe they're the Quechua. I can't remember the name of the tribe, but they're in Ecuador. And he wrote a book called The World is As You Dream It. And, you know, in shamanistic terms, the whole idea of shape-shifting is about transformation, really, and transforming oneself from the essence that we are in this life form that we have as a human being into another one. Could be an animal, or it could be that we could shift into a whole other era, for example, which is what my work is about, and which is why I started this company and named it Shapeshift Dream Productions, is because I believe that we can co-create a new dream. That the dream that we've been living is has become a nightmare. So let's shapeshift out of this nightmare together into a new world. And I think that we don't realize, we honestly, seriously, don't understand our own power. It's not just our own power of choice, like physical choice, but I'm talking about our own psychic power as well. When people get together in groups, you know, it's truly amazing. It can be incredibly powerful and transformative. So anyway, that's what my company, you know, represents, and it's what it's about. And it's the kind of work that this movie, A Crack in Everything, is about as well. Okay, so Rise PDX says, Perkins rocks. Yes, he does rock. He does rock. And he's a great, powerful speaker. And anyone who is watching this should check him out. Let's see what else. Who controls the reviewers? Aha. Fuzzit asks, who controls the reviewers? And I suppose you're referencing the New York Times review and the fact that John's book was on the New York Times bestseller list for 52 weeks without getting reviewed. And what he says about that is that, you know, there were people in the New York Times that didn't want his book to be reviewed because they were told not to review it. You know, it was sort of like, okay, well, you know, let's just ignore this and maybe it'll go away, right? And even the State Department, you know, issued a statement that everything that John said was made up, basically. Or they basically barely even acknowledged it. But when they did finally acknowledge it, they said that, or they claimed that it was all made up. Well, of course, you know, of course they would say that. And of course, the New York Times, I understand why they didn't review it. But doesn't that tell people something? You know, that it's never happened in the history of books that have been on the bestseller list for that amount of time. It's never happened that a book has not been reviewed. So obviously somebody told them not to review it. So let's see, what's the next question? Where is Shapeshift Dream? Okay, Fuzzit asks, where is Shapeshift based? Have you considered making Iceland or some location that comes closer to or further from the power? I am such a fan of Iceland. I can't even tell you how often I've thought of moving there. So it's definitely something that I would consider. And I think that what the Icelandic people have done is so brave and so beautiful. And I can't say enough great things about Iceland.
Well, Iceland, just to interject, is my adopted homeland. I lived there for 5 years. And speaking about Perkins, there's lots of examples in his book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, about Iceland. There's actually two amazing, amazing Icelandic films that came out in 2010 that have Perkins in it. The first one is Dreamland, and the other one is Feathered Cocaine. Both were in Hot Docs, which is almost impossible to get into. It's in Toronto, Hot Docs. And yeah, Iceland is amazing. They've totally turned it around. They're the only ones to have referendums about whether to bail the banks, and both times they said no. They jailed banksters. They're turning things around. Yeah, they got it going on. You know, I lived there for 5 years, from 99 to 2004. They adopted me. It's my adopted homeland. They even granted me, they're really strange. They're like mischievous little elves, right? They got a thing called, you know, the final arbiters of Icelandic ancestry. They're insane for documentation. It's an archivist's dream there. And so they granted me Icelandic ancestry. It's beautiful, beautiful. I will live out my life and be buried there. So thank you, Fuzzit, I think it was, because I'm blind here. Oh, my God. And said that you should, Rise, that you should consider, you know, Iceland. And if you do, I'll set you up.
Oh, great. Because I'm telling you, it's been a dream of mine for a while. And I just can't say enough great things about the Icelandic people. So.
Take some more questions.
Okay. He comes closer. Fuzzit says, comes closer to what we believe, exactly, like the MSM news stories, Ferguson, Oakland, Tokyo, fill in the blank where this dissension or disagreement with the status BS. So it's not really a question, but I think that one of the things that we need to continue to do more of is to continue to take what's hidden, you know, because there's a lot of things that are being hidden and being not reported, you know, in the mainstream media, and we need to take what's hidden and bring it to light. And I think a lot of people talk about also this time that we're living in astrologically too. I mean, I think there's a lot of sort of convergence of different ideas of how this time that we're living in is very much about bringing things to light. It's another like reference in the movie to light, because yes, the title of the movie is there's a crack in everything, but there's always that reference to, but that's how the light gets in. So what is that light? And there's this struggle, this eternal struggle, I believe, that is within each one of us, between shadow and light. And we all have this sort of innate thing within us. It's sort of this destructive element. It's the self-destructive thing. And even in, you know, Eastern Indian philosophy, there's this concept of, you know, creation and destruction. You know, we're constantly in this cycle of creation and destruction, and that's happening within ourselves all the time because of the, you know, when you think about what goes on in our cells, you know, the cells are, you know, growing and then destroying and growing and destroying, and you know, it's what's happening on this one level, but on the larger level even. We have this destruction that's happening that is that, you know, microcosm of a macrocosm. So, you know, I think that it's really a very key time for us to come together and understand that we can get to the light. Let me see another question here. Fuzzit says, what other movies have you done, and would you permit them being played on live stream channels? Of course. I actually have on Facebook a few pages, I have my own Facebook page, but then I have like a Facebook page for the Crack and Everything film, which has 3,000 people. And then I have something called On the Road to You, which was a short film that that I was in, and I also produced, and was Shapeshift Dream production film. And then we have another one called Paradise River. And some of my other work is not necessarily on Facebook, but I would love to have it done on. I would love to have it live on. What did he say? Play them on live stream channels. Yes, I would love that. So. Or even any of the videos that I put together to talk about this subject in reference to the movie. I've got quite a few of those So on the Kickstarter page too, I think I have, I don't know if I have two or three. And then I made one recently because I was so angry at the dismal statistic of the lack of female, representation, sort of in mainstream, films. It just made me really angry. So I made a video specifically addressing that. It's just a video. I mean, it's just me talking. It's not a movie or anything. It's just, one of my rants. It's not a rant. It's just, was just talking about the movie and, the importance of balance really, which is key, I think, to this time. And actually, that's another part of what John Perkins talks about when if you ever have heard him speak, publicly, he talks about the importance of this balance between male and female. And I think he also spent some time with the Dalai Lama, and the Dalai Lama says that it's the woman that would, I think he's specifically the Western women. I mean, I don't necessarily agree with him. I think it's just women or feminine energy that will so-called save the world. But I think it's more that it's the feminine principle or the feminine energy that needs to be in balance. And so what else? Let me see if there's any other questions. Fuzzit says, I just signed up for Facebook since I now have an Iceland email. I will join that in contact. Thank you. Great. Yes, if anybody's listening to this and wants to connect with me on Facebook, I post daily. I mean, there's between my own page and the Crack and Everything page, and then I have another one called Climate Shifters. I post a lot about all of these issues that we've been discussing tonight, fracking, renewables, climate change, women in film. And actually, I also have a web domain name that I coveted and I got called Watch a Chick Make a Flick.com. Because I wanted to actually create a way for new filmmakers, young, old, whatever, women, to have a place to come to. So I just started by blogging, so I'm just blogging for now. But when I have more time after I've made this movie, I really want to create a way for, women to feel empowered, to be able to, have the courage to stand up and make a movie. And I think that's really important. As I said, I want to see more projects done by women, as well as more projects about these subjects, these important social issues and environmental issues that we all need to pay attention to. So I've been blogging. I think it was a while since I made my last blog because I haven't had that much time to be blogging, but I do encourage people to women, to check it out, because I've been sort of talking about my process, the whole process, and the reason why, I came to this, I guess, revelation that I had to stand up and start making movies. Because I was an actor. I mean, I didn't have to become a director or anything. I just got really angry, I guess, at the lack of interesting female roles. And one of the things that led me there was I was working in Rome for a production company, and one of my jobs, this was when I was quite young, one of my jobs was reading scripts, and a lot of these scripts were sent to this particular production company in Rome as possible co-production deals. And I think I have to say that out of all the scripts that I read, I don't think I read one that had really any kind of really interesting, real characters that represented women. I mean, for the most part, they were like, very token characters. It was so bizarre. It was like for every, really great, interesting, maybe 10 male roles, there may have been one female role that was sort of, just one of these like stereotypes, either the girlfriend, the housewife, or the hooker, I mean, it was infuriating. So that's what made me decide to to branch out and you know, stop complaining and, you know, maybe try to do something on the other side of things. So anyway, so I really want to see, I would really love to see women, you know, other women like myself, you know, or like someone like Lena Dunham, you know, I'm sure there's so many women like this that, you know, have beautiful and wonderful ideas and wanted, you know, storytell through the beautiful medium of filmmaking. But they just don't find that much, support, you know, that's the problem, is that there isn't as much support for women in this medium. I mean, and I'm talking about like on a wide level and in Hollywood, because think about what's, you know, the lack of women being acknowledged, because I'm not saying that there aren't women directors. I'm just saying that they're not being acknowledged, and they're certainly not being allowed to make the kinds of movies that get distribution deals. So, you know, if Catherine Bigelow is the only one that's being acknowledged and her work isn't necessarily, you know, just, you know, representative of all women, you know, it's sad. And you know, my goodness, she won, you know, the Academy Award for Best Director, but my gosh, that's never happened before. How could it be that after all these years of, you know, Oscars, you know, this was the first time that, you know, Catherine Bigelow, that a woman won an Academy Award for directing? Anyway, I just think it's just crazy. We live in, this is 2014, and it's still just pathetic. Anyway, let's see.
And the Oscars started in 1929, by the way.
Okay, so since 1929, there's only been one woman acknowledged for her directing. I mean, come on. How can that be? I mean, that's just crazy. So that's why I'd like to see more, you know, more women. And I think that that's going to help, you know, because storytelling is so important. This is how, where people get, you know, it's in the collective conscious, right? So if we want to sort of infiltrate the collective unconscious in a powerful way, we need to change that horrible imbalance by having more women's stories. And I'm not saying that, you know, we have to just suddenly have only women's stories. You know, I'm just talking about a balance. I mean, can we just at least have a balance? Anyway, that's my little rant for the moment.
Beautiful. Take some more questions.
Okay. Fuzzit says, the patriarchal regime can be worked against them. I'm not sure what you mean by that. Let's see what else. Yeah, and Rise PDX says, women are mostly abused in Hollywood, abused and objectified. And that's one of the many reasons why I boycott MSM now. And, you know, this is very true. There's a lot of abuse and objectification. And I think that it's difficult for women to find their place because there's so much pressure to kind of fall into a certain place, okay? So you have to look a certain way, you know, like you always have to. Women are, like, there's so much pressure for women in Hollywood to look perfect. I mean, you have to look perfect. You have to have the perfect nose. Everything has to be, your makeup has to be perfect. Your hair has to be perfect. Your nails have to be done. You know, like, it's just, there's so much pressure for women to just that whole way of looking, okay? Whereas, you know, men can look anyway, right? So how is that fair? You know, like, I just don't see how that's fair. Why do women have to be forced to, you know, just always look a certain way? You know, what if you don't feel like dressing up? What if you don't feel like putting makeup on or putting, you know, your hair in curlers and, you know, torturing yourself to, like, you know, look, you know what I mean? Look beautiful. It just seems that there's so little regard for just honoring a woman for who she is inside, you know, like the beauty of a person as they are and their talent, not just the way that they look. So that's the thing that upsets me about Hollywood. And I just feel like there's so many women that whose voices aren't being heard, and their stories aren't being told because of that. Let's see. And then Rise PDX says, Hollywood, well, it's all the same. Women are the best storytellers, in my opinion, most creative in positive ways. And then Fuzzit says, me mom told me so many stories. Rise PDX says, yeah, me too. And who reads books to kids? Mostly women. And Fuzzit says, stories of World War II. Fred 101 says, time to even the score. Rise PDX says, even perfect women in Hollywood don't feel it's good enough and go under the knife. It's disgusting. Rise PDX, yes, they all get the same plastic surgeon that made Joan Rivers look like a cat creature. Yeah, you know, I'm sorry, but I feel so sad when I see women forcing themselves to do something like that. I mean, like to go under the knife like that. Sorry, I get emotional because it's just horrifying. It's horrifying that women feel that kind of pressure, that they have to turn themselves into something that it's just like, I mean, it's horrible. And that to me is not, when we're talking about beauty, let's talk about beauty, okay? That's not beautiful to me. Like, I think we need to redefine what beauty is. Very often I've seen an old person's face, you know, like just this beautiful lines all in their, just entrenched in their face, right? But there's a sparkle in their eye and there's a beauty in their soul, in their essence. And that to me is much more beautiful than something that our culture would term as perfection, in like this beautiful complexion and everything's perfect, perfect nose, perfect eyes, perfect everything, right? Like a robot, you know? And then it leaves you cold. So I think we need to really redefine what that even is, what beauty is in our culture. And I know a lot of people talk about it, but I still think that there's so much pressure. It's just, there's so much pressure for us women. It's like, we just can't catch a break. If we just can't just be ourselves. Can we just not have to like always look that way? I'm not saying that, okay, I'm sure that a lot of women think it's fun to dress up. And of course it is. Of course it's fun to dress up and look nice. And who doesn't want to look nice? But, you know, I'm just saying that there's too much pressure. And of course, you know, keeping up with the Kardashians, you know, that whole like thing is so like obscene to me. Like, that show, I watched it for the first time a few months ago, and I just was literally, I was floored. I just couldn't believe it. I mean, I watched it only because I was like, okay, well, because I don't actually really watch TV. I haven't had that much time to watch TV these past couple of years because I've been putting all my focus on this project and on, you know, also just getting the word out about fracking. But anyway, so I finally watched the show, and it just blew me away. I couldn't believe. I still can't believe that women would want to emulate the Kardashians. I mean, why would you want to spend $60,000 on a handbag when people in the world are, I just think that's obscene. People are starving and you're spending $60,000 on a handbag? No, I'm sorry. There's something desperately wrong with that. And that to me is not beauty. I'm sorry. It just isn't.
And that handbag is probably built by child labor somewhere in the third world. You know?
Yeah, and there's talk about a disconnect. There's such a disconnect. It's like there's no consciousness about, you know, it's like, oh God, I've got to have that handbag that Kim Kardashian has, you know, because Kim Kardashian has it. Really? Well, you know what? I really think that if Kim Kardashian really knew the kind of influence that she's having in a negative way, and if she understood that if she actually shifted, that she could tomorrow shift the way that she's living her life, and she would actually cause a revolution in a sense. I mean, in a good way, like she really could, she could transform a lot of people's lives because she has that much influence, but she's not thinking of that way. She's just stuck in this, you know, this mode of being, you know, and that's the other thing that upsets me is that I find that there's so many people in, you know, in Hollywood, you know, celebrities who they just don't realize that they have a responsibility. You know, they, it got to a certain level of fame. And with that comes responsibility, okay? But they don't take that responsibility seriously. And very often, a lot of them are too scared to speak out. You know, someone like Daryl Hannah and Neil Young, you know, Neil Young being, you know, in the music side of things, and Daryl Hannah being, you know, from the Hollywood side of things, I admire her greatly for what she's doing, you know, speaking up and standing up for what's right. And I wish there were more people like her not being afraid to say what's so, not being afraid, you know, of being blacklisted in Hollywood, you know, because guess what? Hollywood isn't everything. You know, I mean, there's other ways to make movies. There's other ways to, you know, to get support and to live your life, you know. And I just think that it's, you know, those people that are stuck in that illusion of like how it has to be are selling themselves short. Well, they're selling everybody short, really.
Yeah, I want to give big ups to Daryl Hannah. She's done more in Hollywood to really expose fracking. There's Gus Van Sant, and who did his film last year, the fracking film, the only other Hollywood fracking film and stuff. There's not many. It's not like the old days where there were more left in Hollywood, and you know, in the 60s and 70s, and now they got to worry about their image and this and that, and a lot of it, you know, contractually they can't even speak about this or that. I mean, it's gotten absolutely, you know, Matt Damon's I forget the name of that fracking film. Gus Van Sant. I mean, it's Gus Van Sant. You know,
The movie was called The Promised Land. Promised Land.
It didn't do as well in the box office as it should have, you know, but it's something. When we need more films, I think, you know, as a doc filmmaker myself, there's a lot of great documentaries about fracking, which is getting the word out, and it's educating people. But we, you know, we need to also have our narrative films, and you got Promised Land, and that's it, and then there's yours. I can't think of any other narrative film that is dealing with fracking, and we need more.
We do, because it's not like, you know, it's so pervasive, you know, it's such a pervasive topic, and there's so many different, you know, aspects to how one can tell a story about it, you see. And I agree with you. It's interesting to me. I just find it curious that after the first time that I went to Pennsylvania and I was talking to, you know, the people whose lives had been affected so deeply, you know, a lot of these towns were the towns that probably a lot of people are familiar with, Gasland 1 and Gasland 2. And actually, Josh Fox is a neighbor of mine. He lives up in this area too. You know, I think that the thing about, you know, watching a documentary is that, it's factual, it's great, and they're really important. All these documentaries are really important. But, you know, a narrative film, I think, can move people in a little bit of a different way, and also can reach different people, you know. And I think it is really important to tell these stories. And what I was going to say was that after I went there and I went to, you know, I went to Pennsylvania and I was talking to people, I came back and I was asked to speak at various different events about my research and, you know, what I'd seen. And I told, you know, I would tell people, I was like, you know, has anyone gone to visit? I mean, this was like in New York, like this was even in Woodstock, you know, and, you know, there's a lot of really hip people in Woodstock, you know, that are pretty attuned to what's going on and, you know, what's really going on. But what surprised me was that there weren't that many people that you're talking about that had been to Pennsylvania or that had really seen firsthand the effects of fracking in communities, you know, aside from watching Gasland or, you know, watching another documentary. You know, I told people that, hold on a second, am I still on? Okay, because I just got a thing that said there's an internet problem, so. Okay. Okay. Well, anyway, so I lost my train of thought. So what I was surprised about was that I didn't see that many people really going to see things with their own eyes, you know. And I think that I mentioned this in another show that I was on earlier this week about the Quaker concept of witnessing things, you know. And I think that we live in a time where I think there can be a tendency for people to get scared and, you know, lock themselves in their house or something because they're just too scared. That I think that we need to really break through that fear, or those of us who are afraid, you know, of going out and actually seeing things and, you know, going to some of these communities that are being affected by this crazy, you know, drilling that's going on. I think it's really important because I think that when you see something with your own eyes, it's different than actually, you know, watching a movie or, you know, seeing a documentary or anything. I think looking at something and talking to the people yourself is also just key. Because it really changes. I mean, like just what happened to me by going into, you know, these towns, you know, Towanda was one of them, and Dimmock, of course. I mean, I'll just, these experiences will just always, they'll just always be with me. I'll just never forget what I experienced there. So I think there's a bunch of questions. There's certainly a lot of talking here. So a lot of chatting. Let's see. Fred09 says all filmmakers should go independent and forget Hollywood peer pressure and approval. Blaze your own trail. Yeah, we need to blaze our own trail, and we can, we should. I think filmmakers should take heart in that we're living in an age when it's certainly less expensive now to make a movie. You know, you don't have to spend a gazillion dollars to make a movie because of the technology and these great cameras that we have available. You know, it's a really exciting time because I think a lot of the cameras that are available now are starting to make the product look more like film, which to me is important because I come at this from maybe a more of a European sort of, I look at it more in terms of like creating a painting, you know, like I like painting with light, you know, like I like the element of light in a film. There's some cameras that can help you get closer to that, because obviously if you're going to shoot on film, it's going to be cost prohibitive for an independent filmmaker. Let's see, where else? Often, fuzz it. Even with Hollywood, how do you get around the status distribution of movies? That's a very good question, fuzz it. How do you get around distributing your film if you don't go through Hollywood, you know, connections? There's a lot of ways to get your movie seen. And I think the internet is revolutionizing everything, really. And also, I mean, let me take Josh Fox, for example. You know, he's just tireless in going around the world, really organizing screenings of Gasland 1 and Gasland 2. And he's getting the movie seen. I mean, he's getting that movie seen everywhere. I guess, you know, you could call it guerrilla style distributing. You know, I just think that where there's a will, there's a way. So if you have a movie that you're just passionate to get out there and have people see it, maybe you might not be able to get it into the biggest cinemas that are out there, but you can certainly follow Josh's lead. You can also, you know, you can get it into film festivals, and if you get enough attention at a film festival, for example, and it becomes an indie favorite, you know, in the film festival or festival favorite, you can get a lot of attention that way. So, I mean, I think there's a lot of ways to for independent filmmakers to get their work out there. Certainly a lot more now than before. Let's see what else. was it? I think that where Livestream, okay, wait. I think that's where Livestream would pay off, preview and channels. Yes, yes, I agree with you.
Actually, I have lots of ideas about that question. As a matter of fact, I've been live streaming for 13 years, since 2002 in Reykjavik. I started live streaming as an offshoot of film exhibition. Longer than anything that I've done, I've been in film exhibition, then a photographer, filmmaker, now live streamer. I actually started, doing what's called, it's a concept called open screenings. It came out of the New York experimental film scene in the 60s, and Toronto took over the last 30 years as the open screen capital of the world, where any filmmaker that shows up, we screen it. And surprise, it was a way to take a non-existent indie film scene in Reykjavik and turn it into a healthy scene. We quickly found that we had a lot of international submissions. So we always, as part of the open screen, we always encouraged, like any film festival, it was always a mini film festival, it was once a month, right, of filmmakers to do a 30-second, a minute intro, and then take Q&A from the audience. Really try and also turn the filmmaker into a rock star, so to speak. I totally take a lot of cues from rock and roll. So as a way to carry on that and having international submissions, we had the concept right away in 2002 that we used Livestream as a way to not only increase the worldwide audience to the screening that film, but as a way to distribute it. For example, and of course, technology for live stream was not available, but this is how we envisioned it. One, we would have that open screen in Reykjavik, right? But the filmmaker happens to be, like you, in upstate New York, right? And we're screening that film live to the audience in Reykjavik, but as well, we wanted to be able to take questions from, say, Mei Ling in Beijing or Sandy, in Australia, and really put all that on the screen as well in Reykjavik and on the screen, so that you really have that connectivity with the filmmaker. Like your Josh Fox example was a perfect example. But what if Josh Fox was to do that as a live stream and schedule, say, a live stream where he would introduce the film, show the film, and then take Q&A from what either a live audience there with him or anywhere on earth. But here's the whole kicker and the whole point of the whole thing. While you're watching a live stream, there's a button if you want to order that video, right? And so to take the film festival sort of model, but globalize it, to me, that's why I started live streaming. And I know that that works, right? I've never to this day been able to exercise that full-blown experimentation, but what it did for me, even though the live stream technology wasn't, it started me on the live stream path as a filmmaker. And it's always been about film exhibition and distribution, and that I know it works. And we should try it because I know it will work. Any comments?
Yeah, I agree. I think that's a great idea. And what you were saying before about this, this medium is, we're just sort of at the beginning of its power. So I think that's a great idea you have. Definitely.
Plus, with myself and Rise and a whole bunch of others, you're talking to the pioneers and of this. So you're in good company. And this is your first live stream. And take some more questions from the live chat.
Okay. Let's see. Free speech. Rise PDX says filmmakers could make much more profit cutting out the Hollywood middleman. Yes, 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 yes. Fred 109, do you use a GoPro Hero or any other equipment you like to work with? We're going to be shooting with the Arri Alexa for this movie, which is an amazing camera. And let's see what else. Fredo 109 says democratize the screen. Yes. was it? I was just, you guys are funny. You're just making me laugh. I love that yard thing. And this is so awesome.
Really? I never heard that.
I love it. It's like, isn't it like Popeye?
No, it's a pirate thing. It's a pirate thing.
Okay, so Fuzzit says, many theaters are locked into contracts, but independents are open for satellite or internet replay. Yes, yes, indeed. What else? Rise PDX says, it's great how all the streamers push the technology forward. Yes. We all learn from each other, probably similar to directors of films too.
I can't help but thinking, you know, filmmaker to filmmaker, you know what this reminds me of? You know, when you're before shooting, you do a script read through, you know, with just you're just around the table and this and that. Well, this is a live script that you're reading, and you're doing it beautifully, by the way.
I know. Well, it's so much fun. I can't believe how much fun it is. I love everybody's comments. And you know what's really, really interesting is that it's doing a show like this or interview or whatever you want to call this is so it's actually making my brain. I think it's creating more cells in my brain because I'm using my brain in all these different ways. And it's called neurogenesis, right? You know, like generating new brain cells. And I have a friend, he's an awesome guy, and everybody should friend him or follow him on Facebook. His name is Alex Lightman, and he's kind of a genius, went to MIT. But, you know, he talks about that. He talks about neurogenesis and the importance of, you know, really doing certain activities that will help stimulate these cells in our brains to regenerate themselves. So this is definitely going to be, this is definitely on his list, I'm sure, of like, because you kind of, we're doing all these things at the same time, but we're having a conversation with, I'm having a conversation with you, and I'm also having a conversation with multiple people on this chat, and also talking about my movie. So it's very cool.
In having a lot of fun.
In that vein, let me tell you, there's no such thing as a dictionary definition. And here you're speaking to, you know, the one that's been writing live streams here the longest, 13 years. My dictionary definition of live stream is half of what it is to live stream happens on the live chat. The other half happens on screen, what you and I are doing, and somehow you merge the two into a meaningful discussion towards social change. That is the definition of live stream, and that's why a lot of people bring too much baggage to live stream because of that interactivity. Like on our side here, we artists who are producing and editing in a weird way and exhibiting at the same time, we've never, on any artistic medium ever, we've never had, at the moment of creating that art form, having the audience interact with that and shaping that discussion. And on the other hand, you know, on the audience's side, they've never been able, you know, in the creation of any art form, be able to participate in that creation. So, like I said to you in the tech setup before this, you know, get into the rhythm of three things that are very important for that interactivity is to read the person's name, their question, and answer it. It's really, really simple, right? That is the key to live stream. And for your first live stream, I put it bluntly, you're starting at the top.
I hear you. That's so cool.
Take some more questions.
Okay, sure. So I think I may have already mentioned this, but somebody asked me what camera I was using. So I'm using, from before, so I said on the chat, I'm using the Arri Alexa for this movie. And then Fred says, thanks, Varushka. And Fuzzit says, many theaters are locked contracts, but independents are open for satellite. I think I said that already. Okay, what's the next? The Rise PDX says, it's great how all the streamers push the technology forward, probably some of the directors of film. Bussett says, how much do I have to donate to say yar on your film? We'll have to figure that out. We could come up with some kind of negotiation. Let's see.
I'd say X marks the spot, and you need a treasure map for that.
Yeah, you do. We definitely need a treasure map. and then Rice Peter says, it's all fun and games till the trolls come.
We know how to deal. By the way, Fred109 is our co-head mod here at Occupy Toronto. If live stream director and host like I'm doing our equivalent on the live chat side, because remember half of what it is to live stream, we have two co-head mods here at Occupy Toronto. We know how to deal with trolls. That's Fred109 and Lady Zaga, who's taking some time off. We eat trolls for breakfast. I've written a lot of theory about trolls. Trolls are people that love to stop discussion or steer it into nothingness, right? Because remember, it's all about creating that discussion, which like I said, you're starting off at the top because there's a beautiful rhythm between the live chat and what's going on here on screen. And trolls like to disrupt that. Our motto in dealing with trolls is don't feed the trolls. If they come on and they start talking shit to disrupt the conversation or steer it, just let them be. If they cross the line of being racist, sexist, or any ist, you got someone like Fred109 or Lady Zaga that just bans their arse, and then you keep on going. But for example, in Ferguson, you got a lot of new live streamers popping up like every day. Like last night, there was two brand new ones. And so many of those live streamers are having major troll problems that there's not much discussion going on the live chat. Bella Echo, she's got great moderators. Rise is a mod on her live chat. They got great discussion. But someone like Basim, you know, he's got problems. You know, even the season pro, Revolutionary Zed, he's got so much troll problem. He's had to shut off the live chat. So here you got, you know, certainly the magnifying glass is on Ferguson right now. But you really, the way I see it, and I've been, and Rise and everyone, you know, that the only true discussion going on that live chat is really Bella Echo is the way, I always pronounce it wrong. And that's a shame, you know, but in what's going on in Ferguson, in modern day police actions, when you have an equal number of say 100 or so officers, doing an action to clear a crowd and whatnot, you got an equal amount of police trolls nowadays who are just trolling social media. Again, the sword and shield is the live stream. So they're really trolling all these live streams to stop discussion. Racist. You cannot believe some of the racist comments. And a lot of these live streamers that are really, as I like to say, they're popping up like weeds in the field of democracy down in Ferguson. Training is sadly needed. I'm helping with the training and others. But they need a lot of help with moderation, because even though they're getting the word out and they're there in the front lines, the discussion on the live chat is sadly lacking. And any comments about that, Varushka?
Wow. Well, I think he's pretty much said it all. I mean, I think that's I think it's really interesting that you're sort of on the cutting edge of something, and that these trolls that, you know, you have to try to figure out how to deal with some of the negatives that can obviously, you know, come into be with such a medium. I don't know. I mean, it's sort of like life, isn't it? It's sort of like I always think that there's just people out there who are sort of like the haters, or whatever people call them, the haters or whatever, people who just want to disrupt something. I think sometimes, depending on, you know, what it is, or what the conversation is about, sometimes these people actually work for others who are actually sending them out, you know, certainly on some of the climate you know, change pages that I've been on, there've been a lot of trolls and people, you know, trying to create problems or, trouble. But I think that it's really how do you handle it in real life? You know, like, how do you handle people who, I mean, I think we all have to, face the fact that, you know, when you stand up or you start to speak out, you're going to have people throw rocks at you, you know, or they're going to try to disrupt what you're doing or, you know, and on a spiritual level, you know, I was talking about a lot of different levels, and on a spiritual level, you know, when we talk about that kind of thing, like with these obstacles, you have to just keep really stay very focused, and, you know, keep with your vision of something. So, you know, you can't let yourself be brought down by the so-called haters or trolls or, you know, negative thoughts or whatever it is that's, you know, that's preventing you from moving forward. And really, let's face it, I mean, it's very difficult in this world sometimes to get things done. You know, it's just you have to go through all these things to, like, you know, you have to be really focused on a goal, you know, to actually get it done. You know what I mean? Like, I think that there's so many things that could be thrown in your way, including your own self. I think that very often we're our own worst enemies. So maybe we're our own worst trolls, you know? So we really have to, just work through any problems. So what I appreciate about you with this show is that, it seems like whenever we went down, it was like, oh, it's fine. You know, it's just part of the thing, you know, whereas in the old days, you know, of broadcasting, it was like, oh my God, you know, something went wrong. You know, if something went wrong, it would be not wrong. I mean, it's not really wrong. I mean, it's just, for a minute we lost picture, but we still had communication with the people that are out there. So, you know, it's sort of like experimentation side of things, that the things that are happening in live stream, it seems, is sort of parallel to what's going to be happening with how we're all going to be working together in these crazy times that we're living in, you know? I mean, it's crazy. These times. And so we need to figure out ways to, we have to keep figuring it out as we're going along. You know, we have to figure out, okay, well, this is happening. We've got this going on, and we still have to stay focused and on purpose with each other. Okay. See, Rise PDX says, yeah, you do have to take question is occurring. Fuzzit says, banned dozens of on Bella's stream last night. Wow. Rise PDX, he switched to Ustream because of it. I think you're talking about somebody that was on here. I'm not sure.
No, Revolutionary Z, he's had a lot of, he's a seasoned pro. He's had a lot of problem with trolls, and he's had to shut off his live chats. It's really sad. Bella, yeah, I mean, it's getting out of control. They're really stopping the discussion, and that's an organized paid police trolls doing all that. And we're talking dozens upon dozens of live streams, just specifically out of Ferguson.
That's terrible. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what can be done about that. Other than you just have to keep going. You have to figure out other ways of getting past these trolls.
I know how to deal with it. For example, we had a live stream roundtable in August of 2012 just to identify what's our number one problem in the live stream world. And we identified, there's not even a close second, training is the problem. Right? There's no place to be trained, right? And equipment isn't the problem. A live streamer, you know, it's because equipment isn't a problem, because if you don't know what you need, it's not the problem. It's training. So what they need in Ferguson big time is training, right? That's what I'm I'm involved in, and that's what's evolving. That's why out of that roundtable, my first, because I come from film academia, and because, you know, I'm the busiest live streamer on earth, I have 4,800 streams just in the last 3 years. As a filmmaker, I've made over 900 films, by the way. So I was pushed forward to, okay, you got to do the training. Plus, you've been writing all this live stream theory. So on September 2nd, 2012, I started episode one of Shanger's How to Live Stream every Sunday at 10 p.m. here. And episode 89 this Sunday. And I've been involved, as is Rise and a whole bunch of others, and I'm actively helping train, and I'm going to be interviewing people, and I might just go down if I could get some financing to do so, but I could train via satellite, you know, through Skype, but moderators are their biggest thing right now as a stopgap measure until the training kicks in full blown. They need moderators, and we'll show those trolls. We'll send them. We eat them for breakfast here at Occupy Toronto.
Eat them, yeah, fry them up.
Yes. A la mode. Any comments or take some questions from the live chat?
Let's see.
You're sort of breaking up there. Repeat that.
Okay.
Yeah, you're still breaking up. It's a problem on my end. We're taking care of it. Just keep talking, and I'll let you know.
Use patient tactics for down destructive, putting yourself up to the universe.
You're sounding like a computer, almost like HAL 9000. Open the pod bay door, HAL. I cannot do that, Dave.
You're making me so much now. Like,
you're still breaking up. That's okay. Keep talking. I'll let you know when we're good.
Okay. But I mean, I'm breaking up. Can you understand what I'm saying?
It's hard to hear you. It's okay. Yeah. We're trying to deal with it. There's a lot of other people using the internet here, and we're trying to take care of it. It's sort of stressing the signal because, yeah, we like to use a lot of bandwidth when you're live streaming. And so, yeah, just keep talking.
It's psychedelic streaming. Psychedelic live streaming.
Yeah, man. Oh.
It's cool. I can see the picture. Like it's all like kind of pixelated and weird. So it's just
Yeah, we're working on the technical difficulties, you know, because that's all part of the, you know, creating that interactive, thing. Nobody's on? Then, that's weird. Varushka, you want to say something?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Okay. We're good now. Okay. Keep going where you left off.
No, I was wondering what some of the people chat were talking about.
Let me do one thing. I'm going to hang up and call you right back. Hold on. Okay. That'll right. Help. Hold on. No, it's on my end.
James, that was hard to do.
what you sound. Yar.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm here.
Okay. Yar.
Me?
Yeah. Your image is coming in.
It wouldn't be on her end.
Yar. Okay, you could start talking, and while your image is buffering in.
Okay, but you can hear me better.
Oh,
now.
Perfect. Okay, carry on.
Why didn't we think of this before?
Well, because there's a procedure. Anyway, first of all, it's a bandwidth thing. It wasn't that, then this always works.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. I guess we were sort of talking about trolls and how to deal with them and even what that energy is about. And, you know, on this one level, I think that we're going to have to learn, all of us are going to have to learn to deal with the trolls, you know, whether they're in real, you know, whatever, virtual life or whatever in our daily activities in our families, in communities. You know, there's always people that are going to try to disrupt you. So we just have to figure out a way to get through it, you know, and past it. And in a way, that's sort of what the movie's about, too. It's about finding ways to get through, get to the light through the cracks. So if there's ever any obstacle that comes up, we can find a way to get past it. So it is sort of like being a shapeshifter, isn't it? I mean, you're shapeshifting, you know, constantly with the work you're doing. You're having to transform like these problems into opportunities, right?
Sometimes I refer to what we do as digital shamans.
Yeah. Yeah, it's digital shamans. I like that. We need to be digital shamans. We need to use what this beautiful, amazing technology is giving us, because I think that you know, we have so many opportunities to use the technology in very creative ways. So I'm just excited. So let's see, what are people saying on the chat? psychedelic, what Fred one and I says, psychedelic shroom zoom, number nine time. Number nine. Okay, rise people.
Under the G9. Bingo.
Yeah. That's what's happening. We got to take off in a minute. We're flying here. Let's see what else. Rise PX, something with network for sure. That's it. I'm giving it all she got, Kevin. So perfect audio. Okay, good. So everybody can hear each other. Fred 109, shaping and shifting people's minds for the better. Yeah, we got to shift those minds. We got to shape shift those hearts with, you know, as sort of a swift kick in the, you know, rear. Some people need a big, I think we need to do that to ourselves. I think we need to give ourselves a kick in the butt sometimes, you know. What else can I say? There's no other questions. Does anybody have any other questions?
Yeah, if for the people watching at Global Rev, if you have any questions for Varushka, you got to come on, pop on to the Occupy Toronto live chat. That's what she has on her screen. We have a question here from Kopit Lodge. Well, no, she wasn't filming in Pennsylvania. How long were you down in Pennsylvania where you got the genesis for this film?
Yeah, well, I have been in Pennsylvania back and forth for 3 years now, back and forth. So I actually moved to be in upstate New York specifically for this project. And some people think I'm crazy to have done that. But, you know, because this area actually that I'm living in New York, upstate New York now, which is Sullivan County, actually it was funny because I had someone tell me, you know, when I was moving up here, they said, are you crazy? You're moving to Sullivan County? They're fracking in Sullivan County. And they were mistakenly thinking about Sullivan County in Pennsylvania, because there's a Sullivan County in Pennsylvania. But I moved up here because I knew it was going to be a long, you know, project. Anyone who understands like this kind of project knows that it takes up a good part of your life. So I really have spent the past 3 years going, you know, back and forth talking to people. And we actually, you know, we did do some filming, but we filmed a trailer, and that was shot around here in Calicoon in New York. But we also, I have sort of a side project as well, which is really amazing, working with a photographer who's a protege of Richard Avedon. And he's incredibly gifted photographer. His name is Mark Stettler. And we started to travel in Pennsylvania, taking photographs of the changing, not just the changing landscape, but also the changing lives of the people there. So, you know, like sort of a photography project. And some of the people that one person in particular that we photographed, wonderful man, Terry Greenwood, passed away just not that long ago from a rare form of cancer. And he was an amazing person. And he was actually in Gasland, in the Gasland movies. And he was the one, I don't know if you remember this, but he was talking. And also he has his own videos. If you look on YouTube, you can look him up, Terry Greenwood. He was the one who was talking about his cows being born deformed or dead. And he lived, you know, he lived right outside of Pittsburgh where it was very high degree of chemical poisoning. And by the way, that area of, you know, just outside of Pittsburgh, unfortunately has been sort of that bombarded with all sorts of industry over the years, you know, the coal industry. So, you know, the degree of environmental pollution there is so high that it's just my opinion that I think a lot of people should be evacuated from some of these areas. But you know, how do you do that? Who's going to do that? You know what I mean? Like, where are they going to go? I mean, if you have a home that you can't sell, how are you going to move? You have no money and you can't sell your property, and where are you going to go to? And no one's helping you. So anyway, that's just a disturbing part of, you know, my research. And, you know, it's been really intense and hard to have to, you know, listen and hear and see what's going on, you know, and it's what kind of keeps me going in a way to see this project through, because believe me, I'm sure you can understand this. Any filmmaker out there can understand that it's just, sometimes you just feel like giving up, you know, because it's, what was it? I can't remember. What some famous filmmaker in the early days of filmmaking said, making a film is like going into war. You know, I mean, it's definitely something that is a huge endeavor and a lot of work and a lot of commitment and dedication. And we're talking about, you know, I haven't even, you know, started. I'm just in pre-production. I haven't even made the film yet. So. And I've already, you know, experienced like those moments in time of like giving up. So, do you know what I mean? It's really a huge commitment. And one I will never give up, because I just believe that much in this project. Do you have any other, are there any other questions there at the lodge?
I have another one. I've watched the preview to your upcoming film, and you'd mentioned that you and your friend had felt like your lives were in danger. Had you guys been physically threatened?
Yes.
Wow.
We were threatened. Yes. And
you know, there are ways that people can be hurt you know. And in fact, I mean, one of the elements to the story refers to something called military-style psychological operations. Are you guys familiar with that?
PsychOps. Oh yeah, yes. The live chat's very familiar with all that.
Yeah, and there's actually a so-called handbook that was being referenced, and one of the things that can break down the morality in a community is by kind of pounding into their consciousness a sort of sense of fear of each other. You know what I mean? So it's sort of like what I was observing, it wasn't just, you know, me being threatened, but I mean, people in the community were threatening each other, or maybe, you know, telling on each other, or maybe some of the people in the community were working for the gas industry and they didn't know who it was. And it's just, there's a lot of really underhanded things things that are quite devious. And if I can read a quote from this article that was written by an Esquire magazine by Tom Chiarella in January of 2013, it's actually on the Kickstarter page, but I'll read it because I think it's so compelling. There's a gold rush going on right now. Man is breaking the earth, looking for natural gas, just as we always have. It's a mad scene with hucksters on every side of the issue. And that's just on the surface. You won't believe what's happening underground. And so, you know, one of the things that I wanted to uncover in this particular story was the underground part of it that a lot of people don't want to, you know, really deal with. It's kind of unsavory. It's all the unsavory part of it, including that the rapes go up. When the boom period of the fracking operation is in effect, the rapes in those communities go up. And also STDs are run rampant because apparently a lot of the women in the communities, you know, a lot of the workers, you know, when we were talking about jobs, right? Well, you know, the idea that jobs are being brought in is really nonsense, because the workers are coming from out of state. So in Pennsylvania, for example, most of the workers were from other states, like, you know, the Dakotas or Texas. A lot of these men, you know, they were men, hiring women in the communities, whether they were married or not, to have sex with them. And so that was one way, I suppose, that the women, you know, we're making some extra money. Anyway, this is something that a lot of people don't really like to talk about, but it's part of the whole theme of, you know, exploitation. So here we are, you know, fracturing the earth, you know, and at the same time, there are these rapes going on and, you know, exploiting the women in the communities as well. So it's very disturbing. It's very, it's certainly not a part of the picture that those people who say that, you know, this is, you know, all these wonderful things about, you know, how this is going to save us, you know, from global warming or whatever, you know, it's just nonsense, because that's not the case. I mean, there's so many negatives to it. Anyway.
John, so, you got a comment? This is John Levi, the Elsa Buktug warrior chief. He's got a comment.
Okay, great. Yeah, we heard about that one, you know, when the women are, you know, being used that way. Yes, and, you know, like, that was our one of our concerns also. And, you know, and like what you said, nobody talks about it, you know, and nobody wants to talk about it, but it is the reality. And, you know, the government protects these, you know, the workers, you know, they're so untouchables, you know, and, you know, I heard they're really, I don't know how to say that, they force them to do that, you know, And, you know, that's another concern, you know, like that we, everybody should look at.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I appreciate that you said that. And, you know, I ask everybody to consider the parallels with the military psychological operations in the war in Afghanistan and Iraq. And there's an excellent documentary that everyone should watch called Taxi to the Dark Side. And it's a very disturbing documentary, but I think it's something that everyone needs to watch, because it really tells a lot about what, you know, how to control people that you've gone to war against. And yet these are people, like, for example, in Taxi to the Dark Side, Dee, I don't know, did you see this? The documentary?
I've heard of it, and I do want to see it. I haven't had a chance to see it, but yeah, I agree with you. Excellent film, excellent reviews, a lot of buzz on it, and I do want to see it now.
Well, basically what it's about, it follows this taxi driver who is thrown in a jail in Afghanistan, and it follows the story of how he even came to be there, and then the filmmaker Alex Gibney, who's who won an Academy Award for this movie, and it's well deserved, because the way that he presented the information was as though he was in a court of law in a way. I mean, it was so beautifully done. I mean, beautifully shot, shocking to hear the interviews with the prison guards, because the prison guards in that prison that this particular taxi driver ended up in were all Americans, and they were all people that had been recruited from I think they were either like former I don't know. They were either drug. I don't know. They were pretty unsavory characters themselves. Strange lot of people, and so to hear them speak and to hear what they did to this prisoner is so horrific. I mean, this man. Okay, this taxi driver who never did anything. He was basically in the wrong place at the wrong time. Was beaten so many times that his legs. That the bones in his legs were turned to mush. Okay, and there was never like any proof of anything. He was in jail without any kind of trial. Okay, and they were told, they believed, and Alex Gibney proves this. Okay, they were basically told to terrorize the prisoners in this way. And coming all the way up to the presidential office, you know. And, of course, that was the time, you know, when Bush was president. And, of course, it was Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, and Condoleezza Rice, who were all indicated or implicated, I should say, in this line of command. I think that these types of documentaries are very important for people to watch, because I think we have to be aware. I'm not saying that, you know, it's easy to sit through a documentary that is that disturbing, because it's real life. But I think it's important, you know, because we have to be educated. We have to understand that, you know, it's something that Martin Luther King said, is that, you know, I can't remember the exact quote, but it's something to the effect of, if there's an injustice somewhere, then, you know, there's an injustice everywhere. It's sort of like we have to take responsibility as a human being alive on this planet for what's going on in another part of the planet if there's an injustice. Do you know what I mean? And the fact that a completely innocent man could be thrown in jail and killed in that way, it's just incomprehensible. And so, you know, this is similar to how I feel about the subject matter, you know, fracking and what's happening on a collective basis around the world in areas that are being drilled heavily like this. And the interesting parallel that we can see with the rise in levels of the level of rape around this country and around the world Okay. Isn't that interesting? Okay, so we're raping. Don't we see that we're raping the earth by fracking, by fracturing the earth and causing these earthquakes all over the place? There's a parallel. It's a violent act. It's a violent act against the planet. And, you know, this is something that I think people need to wake up to, that it's like, wow, okay. We all, every one of us needs to stand up. And as Neil Young says, stand up. I mean, why are people afraid to speak up? We're 99%. There's 99% of the population that, you know, has power. We have that kind of power to shift things and to demand an end to this insanity. We have to demand an end to it. And there's, you know, as I said, there's different ways that, you know, I mean, I'm trying to do something through a movie, but I mean, everybody can do what they can in little ways. And even just talking about it, having conversations, you know, beginning to have conversations. You know, I remember in the beginning of, you know, when I was first learning about fracking and I was sharing on Facebook about it, you know, I had a lot of friends defriend me, because, you know, there's a lot of people that are like, oh, I can't, you know, I'm not, you know, don't talk to me about any political stuff or any, you know, you're too political, you know what I mean? Or whatever it was, is that people, I think a lot of people didn't want to hear or listen to what I had to say, because it was just too difficult to hear it. But the thing is that it's what I said before. It's like, well, you know, so then what are we going to do? Like, hear no evil, you know, see no evil and speak no evil. So we're just going to like pretend that nothing is happening, when we live in a global community now. I mean, we're all together. So if something's happening to a taxi driver in Afghanistan, okay, and his legs are being, and he's being beaten to death for no reason other than he was in the wrong place at the wrong time, and there's this concept of let's, you know, terrorize the people so that, you know, they'll acquiesce more, you know, they'll, you know, psychologically, if we beat them into a pulp, then they'll be our slaves. Do you know what I mean? So we can't allow that. We can't allow something like that to happen to another human being. And that's not even we're not even talking yet about also other species, because, you know, that's a whole other topic, but that's pretty disturbing too. So anyway, if you have any other questions,
you know. Anybody here at Kopit Lodge? And you're watching, by the way, Kopit Lodge's Fracking Show number 20. And live with us from upstate New York is Varushka Franceschi. And she's working on a new film, crowdfunding. It's called Cracking Everything. It's a narrative, aka dramatic feature film. And she's in the pre-production stage. And Varushka, feel free to post the link on your Kickstarter one. There's 4 days left. And I will be uploading this to YouTube right after this. And feel free to use it however you want. Anybody here at Kopit have any questions for Varushka?
When's the release? Does she have one? Or?
One thing about live stream is sometimes you have to repeat yourself. Completion date for this film.
Yes. Our target completion date is December of 2015. But it really depends on a lot of factors, because, you know, as I mentioned earlier, this is, so far, this is totally crowdfunded, this project. And so we're raising money in stages. And So it really depends on, you know, how fast we can raise our funds for the editing, the production phase, and, of course, the marketing phase. So and distribution. So, you know, that requires some funding as well. So if there's anybody out there that this before the 4 days are up, because our crowdfunder, this particular crowdfunder, ends on Sunday, and we have raised $15,000, but all of that $15,000 will be lost if we don't get the remainder. So we really need to get this remainder in order to stay on track with our schedule. And so I encourage everyone, even if you only have a dollar to donate, because I mentioned this before, but like, for example, I have 5,000 friends on Facebook. Every one of my Facebook friends just put in a dollar. That's $5,000 right there. And then the other thing about that that's really great is that then you're a part of something that's bigger than yourself. So you're making a contribution to a way to reach people that is extremely powerful, because film moves hearts. And this is really what we're trying to get at here. We're trying to move people's hearts now, because we obviously can't move people's intellects in the same way. People are not understanding intellectually. They're not getting that. I'm saying a lot of people, a good percentage of people, are not getting intellectually something, but they could get something maybe in the heart. If something really hit them in the heart, if they could see something that really caused a catharsis, okay, for them. And I did an interesting experiment. I put on my Facebook a couple of days ago a question. The question was, there's a Greek word called catharsis. In early Greek theater, Greek tragedy actually, it was known that really great theater could actually move people enough to cause a moment of catharsis, which just really, the translation would be a moment of transformation where you would actually feel moved to change your life in a way, or do or make an action that you wouldn't normally have done. So I asked the question of my 5,000 Facebook friends, or close to 5,000 Facebook friends, have you ever experienced this in a movie? Has there ever been a movie that has caused this kind of experience for you, this cathartic moment, to actually, you know, have you change the course of your life, or just even do an action that you normally wouldn't have done? And I think I had maybe 163 responses. People giving examples of all these great, amazing, moving films that caused them to actually do something different with their lives. And I thought that was really, really beautiful to hear, because that I think that this movie could be maybe one of those. I'm certainly hoping so, and that's certainly my intention. And I have really been following my heart with this. So, you know, it's really a heart project. It's a passion project.
What were some of the films that people answered?
A lot of people. Well, okay, Blade Runner was one. To Kill a Mockingbird, Network was another one. Sophie's Choice. I think somebody mentioned all of Fellini's movies. I was like, okay, goodness, all of Fellini's movies. for me, a movie that really moved me so deeply. In fact, I think when I saw this movie, I couldn't leave the theater for maybe 30 minutes. They had to kick me out of the theater. It was a movie called Map of the Human Heart, by a Australian filmmaker. No, actually, I think he's from New Zealand. But anyway, his name is Vincent Ward. And he did this movie quite a few years back. I mean, it's maybe like 15 years ago. Absolutely stunning movie that I highly recommend. It's just such a beautiful movie that I couldn't move from my seat. I was that moved. I was sobbing so deeply, because it's a love story, but it's sort of one of these stories that talks about a lot of things. Horrors of war.
We're down for a sec. Hold on. We've lost internet connection. We're not live. Hold on. And Yeah. I think even just having him on, and we lost Varushka. Yeah, we're totally down. Hold on, we'll get her back.
The film she made.
No, we're totally down.
Pretty intense.
When did she say it's releasing? Because I think I got totally blurred out.
Yeah, it was like November, I think, eh?
No. Here we go. And we're back.
The person you're trying to reach is currently unavailable. Please leave a message.
There we go. Okay, we're back now. We're back. That was on my end, by the way, and I'm just gonna mute my video to you. And okay, you were giving examples of films that catharsis. That's what you're talking about, where we left off.
In fact, I'm going to see if I can find thread, because I think it was just so interesting. I was really amazed at how many people responded, and very heartened, you know, by that, because I think it's really, it's a powerful medium. Hold on a second. Where is it?
Yeah, and while you're looking for it, for me, in the vein of, Fellini, of course, the foreign filmmaker that's won more Oscars than any other. For me, it's Kubrick, my hero. I mean, I can, and even more so, Nanook in the North, you know, Robert Flaherty is my favorite filmmaker of all time. And then Stan Brakhage, who's an experimental filmmaker. I can name off a bunch of their films and people won't really get it, but really third for me is Kubrick. And more than anything, it was 2001. It's one of those rare films. It's more of a filmic experience, just a visual feast for the eyes. 2001. Have you found it? I'm just filling in time.
Yeah, I know, I can't seem to find it, but I agree with you. 2001, in fact, a lot of people mentioned 2001. And it is an here we go. Okay, oh my gosh. Okay. Gandhi, Betty Blue, Requiem for a Dream, The Passion of Christ, Un Chien Andalou, Battleship Potemkin, Traffic, Five Easy Pieces, which I love that. Yes, Five Easy Pieces, definitely. But a lot of these movies, I think people, you know, are just talking about movies that were wonderful. I mean, It's a Wonderful Life, for example, definitely is one of those movies, I think. There's so many different, what's really great is that there's so many different types of movies, you know, that you can look at, because I mean, if you look at 2001, you know, you compare it to, some of the other, you know, movies that you just mentioned, you know, the Stan Brakhage movies, that look how different they are, you know what I mean? And so I think there's, you know, it doesn't have to be the most produced, you know, because 2001, I mean, my God, what a production, you know, and it doesn't have to be the most produced movie to move you, you know? And I'm trying to think of, let's see what else people said, any more, you know, lower budget movies. I'm curious to see any lower budget movies, that people loved. Of course, a lot of people mentioned The Deer Hunter. What else? Kianaskatsi, a lot of people mentioned that. What else? Bambi. That's a good one. And of course The Matrix. What else? A Map of the Human Heart, really. I still think about that movie. It just for some reason it just blew me away.
What's that about?
Well, it's a love story. It's about sort of this. It follows these two people that fall in love at the young age. They meet at a young age, and it's sort of one of these possible loves, you know, and he follows her. It takes place in Canada, and Jason Scott Lee, who's a, I believe he's from Hawaii, actually. He's, but he's got, you know, he's a mixture of Hawaiian and maybe some other things, but he plays one of the lead roles. And then I can't remember the actress who played the lead role. This is an older movie. I mean, I haven't seen it. I only saw it that one time at the movie theater. They fall in love when they're young, and she ends up marrying somebody else. And he's just, you know, he goes to war, and he ends up being one of the people that bombs Dresden. And it's just such an evocative, like, movie because of this intense love that they have for each other, but they can never be together. So it's sort of like one of those impossible romantic things. And maybe that's just, you know, maybe I'm moved by those kinds of movies more than anything, because I'm such a romantic. But it's really, it's very, very beautifully done. When I'm trying to think of, of course, Sophie's Choice. Do you remember Sophie's Choice?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. That really was a very powerful film that really helped to change things for me. And of course, Philadelphia. And I think Philadelphia was one of those movies that did a lot to raise awareness about AIDS. And I know I talked about it in one of my videos, because I really think that it was a pivotal movie, you know, for people to understand and put a face and a human face to this horrible disease. And what I mean by that is, like, you know, sort of live through these characters in the movie, just the tragedy of it. So,
what's interesting, you talked about your website, chicks that like flicks.com. Did I get that right?
No. It's actually watch a chick make a flick.
Okay. We just watch a chick make a flick.
.com.
Yeah.
What's interesting, you've touched upon here and there that you do videos and it appears on there, correct?
Well, not on the one, no, but that is my, that's eventually what I'd like to do with that site, is to nurture female talent. You know, any age talent, you know, anybody that is interested in developing their work. And so I've just, right now, I'm just starting with my own project by just blogging about being a female in this world of filmmaking that's inundated with men. So for now, it's just a blog, but I do plan to put more videos up there and sort of little mini movies. And actually, what's really, really wonderful about short films, and, you know, I'm going to be doing a lot more short films, is that you can finish them quickly and put them up, you know. So I actually love making short films.
Well, here's a thought, since this is your first live stream, and you can have like a weekly live stream show. And it's easy to sign up for a free live stream channel. I could totally help you out on that. But this interactivity, and I know the time constraints of filmmakers being one as well, that, you know, the key to a weekly show is all you say is, you know, it starts at 8 p.m. Thursday, Eastern Standard Time. You always got to put the time zone because you got a worldwide audience. And how long you go is up to you, whether you go 2, 3, 4 hours. So it makes your life easier. It interacts with people, and it's more meaningful, I think. And we're almost approaching the 3.5 hour mark. That's how time flies on the live stream, right? So I'm just planting the seed that is a thought as an alternative to short films about that, or in addition to. You should do a weekly, you're natural.
Oh, I'd love to. I've been... It's just, you know, there's only so many hours in the day that you can plan things, you know, and I know I made a joke the other day about, you know, can somebody please send me to the nearest cloning station, because I need 10 clones of me right away, you know, because it's just crazy the amount of work that goes into planning all of this and organizing the actor, you know, talking to the actors, tweaking the script, you know, organizing just the locations and blah, blah, blah. I mean, on and on and on. I mean, it just goes on and on. And, you know, because we're dealing with like a no budget or very low budget, it's not like I can hire, you know, 15 assistants, you know, which I wish I could. But I don't have the budget for that. So, so doing a live stream show, I mean, I think would be really great. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure we could talk about it afterwards, and it certainly would be fun. But I still like making short films. So, you know,
and I'm a filmmaker. I understand that. It's something that maybe you hadn't considered. That I understand. I wish there was three or four of me, and I think a lot of us do. It makes your time easier. You know. If not once a week, maybe pick something like the first Tuesday of the month or something like that. And it's a greater interaction. You're just schedule yourself for, you know, that many time, or do it infrequently, where if you have a bunch of followers and I'm going to do it this time. All right. And with Twitter and everything, you could always tweak it like that. I think you're actually live, right? That's the beauty of it, and it's a time saver for you as well, and it's more effective. I've practically, after 900 films and 4,800 streams, I've practically given up filmmaking the last 3 years. I know a lot of my filmmaker friends are shocked at that. It's just I'm built for live streaming.
You are. You're doing an amazing job. And it's really, really inspiring. So, yeah, I mean, I definitely would, you know, be interested. And I suppose that you can, you know, it could be done from all around the world.
Anywhere. I could set it up so that you have the software on your laptop. You could do it anywhere, and you could absolutely broadcast. And actually, think of it this way. Live streaming from a laptop is way more higher quality, right? It's the power of a laptop versus the power of a smartphone, and it's the power of a software versus an app. But you could do both, right? Because sometimes you might be in a situation where you have to live stream from your phone, right? And but that's just, you know, mechanics. It's more what the content is and interacting with your audience.
Exactly. So, do you know if there's anybody who has any other questions, or should I try to read some questions?
From the live chat, yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah. Okay. Fuzzit says, I just tried to donate it to Kickstarter, but they want an FB login. Any other option? Well, as far as I know, you can go directly to Kickstarter. And actually, with the link, I think with the link that I gave, it takes you directly there. I don't think you have to log in, as far as I know.
You don't. You don't. Maybe he's talking about the login to donate, actually donate.
Oh, I don't know. I don't think so. I don't think you have to log into Facebook. I've never, but some people are not on Facebook, so I don't know. People have been.
The login for the, to actually pay. Once they decide to pay, right, what that procedure is, I think that's what he's referring to. I don't think you have to log in. All you have to do is give your, whether credit card or PayPal or I think that, do you know how many the different payment options, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of different payment options. They're really, really good. It's pretty well, if you want to pay, I don't think with Kickstarter, you need any account or anything. It's just the only login thing is how you're going to pay. I never heard of that.
Right. I'm not sure, but if Fuzzit can tell me what screens, if he's had any, you know, success, because I don't know, because he said he was trying to donate, but I don't know if he's had success. Maybe, you know, that means that then he didn't need to go on Facebook, hopefully. I hadn't heard, nobody said anything to me yet about that, so I hadn't heard that there was any, you know, restriction to logging in. And then he says, Notice how all companies now call personnel departments, human resources, as in nothing more than a commodity. Huh. Yes, that's very sad. We're just, I guess, all commodities, but we can change that. So let's see what else. Fred 09 says, "You're a true force of nature, Varushka, a voice to be reckoned with that needs to be heard. Effervescent and fresh." That's so sweet. Thank you. I appreciate you saying that. I'm just following my heart, really, and doing what I'm called to do. But thank you. I'm just really excited because I feel like we're on the verge of something, you know. I mean, like, I really think that we have so much at our fingertips collectively. And that's I think everyone that's alive right now should feel that excitement and should feel that we all have a little bit of power. You know, not just a little bit of power, but a lot of power, but especially more power when we get together. So that's what I'm most excited about, is getting together with people, like-minded people, like all of you here. And also, it's just, you know what, there's something so wonderful about making a film, you know, as a collaboration, and this whole collaborative process of it, that just makes me feel alive. You know, I think that's when I've always felt the most alive, is when I've been working on a project like this. I don't know if do you feel that way too?
As a filmmaker, yeah, in the early days. But see, I always hate saying this, I'm a filmmaker that's made 900 films, and I steadfastly refuse to distribute. It's a really weird thing, which I won't get into now, but the long and the short of it is 95% of my films, because I'm an experimental filmmaker that's chosen the anthropological documentary genre to experiment in. 95% of those 900 plus films, I've gotten less than 24 hours notice. And if I didn't video or film it, it will be lost in the ages. And because there's virtually no money, and I love to document, I develop what's called one-to-one. Everything I shoot in the order in which I shoot it is the final film. So I would make a feature in, I don't know, 2-3 hours. I kid you not. And I'm a master film editor. I know a film theory. I've edited 16, you know. I'm a master of Final Cut Pro and stuff. I love it. It's the best. Because people forget, film editing is different than video editing, right? We need a lot more stuff. So, in the early days, I know exactly what you feel like and stuff. But when I'm in the rhythm that I'm at, I think for 35 years, being in that rhythm of, one, less than 24 hours notice, two, I make a feature, it's all in camera edited, I call it one-to-one. Everything I shoot in the order in which I shoot it is the film. I'm built for live streaming, right? And the fact that I've given up filmmaking, I don't have time to reflect. But I know what you mean, that it's like, oh man, I just need that financing, and oh man, I'm not gonna get it. And it's like, oh, okay, I'm gonna get it. Yeah, I know. And the process of making a film is a slow process, but when it's done right, it's a thing of beauty. I like your example of catharsis. I think with live stream, I think a lot of people do experience catharsis a lot of times. You know, I'm sure enough times during this last 3.5 hours, people have experienced it. It's a thing of beauty. But I repeat, do not bring a lot of baggage to live stream. It's not filmmaking. It's interactive, right? You could be in 30 different places. That's why I refer more than anything, you know, other than using the term live streamer, we are digital shamans.
Totally. Yeah. And that's, you know, I guess my question to you was more, because I was thinking in a way that what you're doing with this live stream is more like your way of making a film, in a sense. I mean, you're making a, you're making this incredible thing that is, it's, it has a force of its own, you know what I mean? It has a life of its own. And it strikes me that you're in your element, you know what I mean? Like, you seem to be in the zone. I mean, you seem to be in the right place. This is exactly what you need to be doing. So, you know, that sense of timeless awareness, when you know that what you're doing is what you're supposed to be doing. I felt that the minute that I, you know, made a movie, because, you know, as I said, I was an actor, and I still love acting. And I think, you know, one of my passions, but, the first time that I made a movie, it was a short film. And actually I edited it on a Steenbeck. You'd be proud of me.
Woohoo! Steenbeck.
Right? Yeah. You know, and it was such an incredible process of, you know, it took a long time, but it was just so, it was really good to learn that way. And that was how I learned how to edit, was, you know, the old fashioned way, you know. But I just never forget how I felt. I was like, oh my God, I felt like I was just home. You know, it was like home. I mean, it was like, I was just meant to do that. I was meant to do this. It was, I love every aspect of it, every aspect of it. I mean, from, you know, just the concept of it, the writing of it, I love everything. I mean, I just love everything about it. And it just really makes me feel, like I'm in some kind of, you know, stream. I'm like in this zone. I'm in this, you know, I'm just in the right place, really. So that's what makes me excited. You know, I just feel like I could just keep doing this over and over again. But as you said, you know, you mentioned money, the money part of it. So it's sort of like, God, you know, wouldn't that be great if I could just have, the support of, you know, some benevolent, people that were just say, hey, you know, here's a couple million dollars. You know, I think that you could do a lot with a couple million dollars. You know, you don't have to spend $100 million to make a really amazing film. And there's so many examples of films, you know, low budget films, that really, were amazing. Did you see the movie Incendie? Canadian.
Which one again?
Incendie. It's a Canadian movie. I think they had a rather low budget. I can't remember their budget, but that's an example of an incredible film.
Do you remember what the English translation? That would be a Quebecois film. Do you know what the English translation would be?
It's
or who the filmmaker is?
I can't remember he's a Canadian. And I don't remember his name. It's a man. It's an extraordinary film, but this is an example of such a beautiful, beautifully shot film. I don't remember if it was nominated for Best Foreign Film, but didn't win. I think so, or maybe it won, I'm not sure, but it's an absolutely stunning movie, but it didn't have a massive budget. But when you look at a movie like that and you think, wow, look at what they did with, you know, the small budget that they had. And yet they made such a powerful film. And by the way, whoever the filmmaker was, who was a man, and I don't remember his name, but the movie was really followed this woman. And it starts off with in an office, in a lawyer's office. And
oh, the palace. Yes. It was oh shit. What's the English title? I have seen it. It was nominated for best foreign film. It was. I forget the filmmaker's name. I forget the English. The Palestinian woman and the daughter and the son go back after she dies.
Mother, because she leaves in their will. She leaves in her will that in order for them to get the money, they have to go back to find out what happened to her. There's some secret. Okay, it's a beautiful. I mean, it's an absolutely beautiful film. Stunning, stunning film in every way. And I was really amazed. This is a great example of a man understanding women. You know, the way he made this movie, and by the way, the woman who, and I don't know her name, the actress, but she is absolutely luminous, amazing, beautiful actress. And, you know, not necessarily, you know, a 20-something-year-old either. And not, you know, wasn't really that well-known. I hadn't seen her work before, but I love her work. I just think she's brilliant. So, anyway, this is a film, actually, that really inspired me a lot because, you know, he did get, you know, quite a bit of acclaim for it, and rightly so. And he didn't have this massive budget. So I think that, you know, we don't have to spend $30 million to make a good movie.
That was a Quebecois film from Montreal, and it bounced back and forth between Montreal, where it began, and I forget what region of the Middle East that they were at.
Okay, Fred 101 says it was a 2010 Canadian mystery drama film written and directed by Denis Villeneuve. And the film won 8 awards at the 31st Genie Awards, including Best Motion Picture and Best Actress for Lubna Azabal. Lubna Azabal, that was her name.
The Genies are the Canadian Oscars, by the way.
Yes, and well deserved, let me tell you. I mean,
forget what the English title was.
Encendie basically means, doesn't it mean fires? Something on fire? That's what I think it means. I mean, I don't know if they if the English, because sometimes, you know, when you have a film in another language, when they translate it, it's not the same. They call it something else. It's not the direct translation. So I don't know. Oh, and then Fred 109 says best director, best adapted screenplay, cinematography, editing, overall sound editing. And it was named by the New York Times as one of the 10 best films of 2011. Yes, I would agree with that. I would agree that this was an absolutely extraordinary film. Really, one of the best films I've seen in a long time. And I really appreciated the way that he told the story. Just an absolutely beautiful story.
There's a huge resurgence in the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years in Quebecois cinema. They're just exploding. Like, I forget the filmmaker's name, Marc Vallès, I think, who, Dallas Buyers Club, right? They're moving into the Hollywood scene. But Dallas Buyers Club, that's totally a Quebecois film. And won 2 Oscars for its actors. So they're exploding into the worldwide scene. I just love the Quebecois cinema. I have a lot of filmmaker friends in Montreal, and it's a beautiful scene, and that's because, you know, the Quebec government really supports the arts, and the film industry is huge because of that, and they really get a lot of financing, not just from the provincial government, but by Telefilm Canada. I mean, and rightly so. Telefilm Canada is the federal financing for films here in Canada.
Wow. Well, I mean, I think that just goes to show you something, doesn't it? That when there's support for the arts in this way, is that people respond. You know, if we had more backing, you know, instead of spending all this money on, you know, the military, why can't we have more art funding in the United States, you know, and like in Canada? I mean, I just think that
Go ahead.
Okay. I just think that when you have you know, people who are receiving support in this way, they create wonderful work, because it's really, I think that's what's hard is, you know, so many artists are, you know, spending all their time just trying to raise money instead of doing what they need to do, which is making the work. You know what I mean? Like sweating the bullets, you know, trying, oh my God, you know, like, you know, for me with this crowdfunder, you know, I'm sweating bullets because I have 4 days, and, you know, and it's not even that much money. I mean, really, $25,000, you know, I mean, when you think about it, it's really not that much money. I mean, that's what, you know, Kim Kardashian doesn't even spend that on a handbag. She spends $60,000 on her handbags.
Unbelievable.
You know, it just seems so silly. It's like, I mean, somebody could just, you know, easily just write a check, go, here's the, you know, $25,000. And, you know, I just, I just think that it's a shame. That's all. It's a shame that we don't have that our priorities are kind of screwed around, and that the priorities are more about, you know, funding wars. We need to fund heart projects. You know, we need to fund each other. We need to, you know, that's just how I feel about it. And so I'd like to see more of that. So I think it's great that in Canada, you know, there's more support. Doesn't surprise me that, you know, that's not the case here, but I don't know.
Yeah, traditionally, there's a lot more financing of the arts here. I mean, under Harper, a lot of things have changed. But one of the reasons why Quebecois filmmakers get more money than English-Canadian filmmakers from Telefilm Canada, a federal financing body, is because if you remember back in the late 70s and 80s, there was a whole separatist movement, and they had three referendums that were really close to separate from Canada. That in the early 90s, there was the closest one. It was like 50-point-something% no to it. And that even the fact that the federal government here in Canada allowed the referendums to take place, and that if successful, they would have separated from Canada. That in the early 90s, what they ended up doing is outline the fact that they can't even do a referendum and separate anymore. And they started a federalist program in Quebec, where if you're a Quebecois filmmaker, I kid you not, you're 100 times more likely to get money from Telefilm. And actually, in any Quebec industry, they just flooded grants. They were giving them away like candy in Quebec, so that, for example, you know, so that they're suckling at the tit of the federal government, and they're so used to that that if they separate, then what are they going to do? So that, yes, Quebecois filmmakers, so that's when it started. So now it's starting to pay dividends, where there's a huge explosion. I am so in love with the Quebecois cinema in the last 4 or 5 years. It's just exploding. We are.
Well, that's really cool. I just wanted to mention something, because Fred had just, while we were talking, had just reminded us, because he did some research here. He says, Incendie, what this is Fred 109 saying that Incendie was adapted from, and I can't pronounce this name, but it's spelled WHJDI, Washdi Muad's play of the same name. It follows the journey of a twin brother and sister as they attempt to unravel the mystery of their mother's life. And the film premiered at the Venice and Toronto film festivals in September 2010, and was released in Quebec on the 17th of September 2010. And in 2011, it was nominated for Best Foreign Language Academy Award. And he says that I was correct that Incendie translates literally directly as fire. So it is fire. But
it's Fred 109, our co-head mod at Occupy
Toronto. Yes, I appreciate that, because I appreciate getting this right. I think it's important, because we want to honor the source material as well. It was a play first. So, I think that it was an extraordinary adaptation. I didn't read the play. I don't know what the play, but, you know, I think that it was just an extraordinary, extraordinary story, that I'll never forget. So
this was a great example of interactivity of live stream, where I said this more than anything, our modus operandi, we turn on a dime, where you mentioned that film, how it moved you, and we didn't quite know the name, but I know Fred's there, and we'll come up with it, and how we got into a beautiful tangent. That's the beauty of interactivity. You don't have to know it all. Rely on the audience, right?
I know, right? Oh, goodness. So much pressure to know everything, right? But that's why we need each other. You know, we really need each other, because everybody brings a little bit more to this beautiful tapestry that we weave together. And you know, that's just really beautiful, isn't it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I love the interactivity of live stream. It's so beautiful. And you sort of touched upon it before we got into this beautiful tangent. You know what my secret is, you know, and why I do say, you know, digital shaman is the secret to what I do is, even though I'm here talking to you, I'm not here. I'm in the audience's mind. I do everything backwards, right? And I also touched upon that in the tech setup before we went live. I remember in Toronto in the late 70s was the world mecca of experimental film. It took over from the New York scene, and they had an entity called the Funnel Experimental Film Theater. On a regular basis, I would see Andy Warhol and the who's who of the experimental film scene. I could rhyme off a bunch of names, but we'll leave it at that. And I remember Andy Warhol would always say, you know, and in hindsight, he was really talking about live stream, but he was talking about film. He says, you know, when you're a filmmaker and you have the camera on a tripod, you've taken the light meter reading, you know, you've set your exposure, you're just about to, you know, turn over the film and shoot that scene, you know what you're doing? Is you're not really there. You're actually the first audience member in front row center. So that you have to put yourself in the viewer's mind, because as a filmmaker, you can only see your film once, you know, so you shoot that film, and if you could do it at the moment that you're actually shooting it, and not to a certain degree the moment that you send it to the lab and next day you watch the rushes, and your first reaction, and why the filmmaker could only watch their film once, is your reaction to that image will be lost, because in the act of editing, you've seen that 1,000 times. So maybe you're a little desensitized, and maybe that's not even the right word, but versus the audience, right, is seeing it for the first time, all cut together. So that, in a sense, what Warhol's trick was, is he was always the first audience member in front row center at the moment that he was creating it. And in hindsight, you know, I have always, as a filmmaker, took that to heart, and this and that. I'm a type of filmmaker, even though that it's 1-to-1, and even though it might be a 2 to 5 hour long film, and the budget is $10 to $20 if the videotape's on sale, right? And it would make that film in 2-3 hours. I know this sounds crazy, but in my films, at any moment in that 2 hour film, at every frame, I could tell you where your eye is at that part of the frame. It's just a gift that I have. That there's no, we experimental filmmakers work at the 1,000th of a frame level. There ain't no grain out of place. The fact that we know where your eye is in that composition, that's a gift of filmmakers, right? And I've never forgotten what Andy Warhol said. I was just a youngins, right? And to have the tutelage of the best of the best there is just amazing. So again, my secret to what I do is, even though I'm physically here, I'm actually in our audience's mind, right? I'm always thinking of them, right? Like, for example, if I'm talking about, I'm here in Nelson Booktog. Yeah, I'm going to go to 134, or I'm going to go to Wilson's and buy a pack of smoke. Well, for us here, yeah, I know the context, but, you know, I try to imagine Mei Ling in Beijing or Bruce in Australia, that, you know, I have to give a little bit more detail as to what that physical space is and you know, questions from them. The fact that for the first time ever, I'm blind here for the last 2 hours and 18 minutes. I can't read the live chat. That's a first in 4800 streams. So, yeah.
Well, you know, one of the things I wanted to, because you brought up something I've been thinking about this a lot, especially because, you know, I think I mentioned that I teach yoga. And one of the things that I teach in the classes is to always be aware of being in beginner's mind. So it's, as a filmmaker, I think one has to, well, it's, that's the way that I would like to come at the material, is to always come at it with beginner's mind. And as an actor, you know, definitely you have to do that because, you know, every time you're, if you're doing a play, for example, if you're doing it 300 times, you know, the 300th time, you still have to do it as though it's the first time you did it, because it's as though it's the first time it's happening, you know? And so there's just sort of a freshness that you, if you can bring that to the work, if you can bring that to every part of the work, in fact, then, you know, even though you've lived with it, even though, you know, as you know, when you're editing your film, you've seen it a gazillion times and you've just, you know, it's just gone, you know, you've gone through this for like 3 years or however long it's taking you to make this movie, you know, or what, you know, maybe in your case, it was just a day. But still, you know, you've seen it over and over again.
2 to 3 hours.
Yeah, 2 to 3 hours. So, you know, but, you know, so, but if you can bring that sense of, you know, beginner's mind and, you know, approaching it that way, I think that that's when, you know, you can actually begin to do, to kind of take off. It's sort of, that's when you get into the zone. You know what I mean? Is that when you are able to get into that freshness. So that's sort of what I seek. And it's hard though, because sometimes, you know, I shot some of the scenes in this particular, you know, in A Crack and Everything. It was sort of like test scenes, you know, and to make a trailer from. And so, you know, I've lived with these scenes, you know, and they're going to be replaying in my mind over and over and over again. And, you know, you can keep looking. And I know other filmmakers who feel the same way. It's like sometimes they'll look at their work and they're like, oh my God, you know, I could have done that better. I could have, you know what I mean? It's hard sometimes to watch something that you've spent so much time preparing, you know, or that whatever, you know what I mean? And so, you know, it's, and then you watch it on this, you know, big screen and you're like, my God, you know, you're just much more critical. You're much more critical of yourself. And I think that can sometimes be hard, but you have to really, you have to be careful about that, because you can't be too critical that you then never, you know, you can never get to the point of something, you know? So you really have to try to be in the moment, I think. There's a sort of Zen approach to filmmaking.
Absolutely. Like as a filmmaker, it was easy for me to adapt to, you know, almost 900 films of one-to-one, where everything I shoot is all in-camera editing. The order in which I shoot it is the film, and I would make a feature in 2-3 hours. It was easy for me to change over to that, because as a filmmaker, as a master film editor, I never, ever, ever, ever once believed in the concept of a rough cut. I think the rough cut was a waste of time, because the key to editing and all the theory that I know, film theory, is you find that thread right off the bat, right? That thread between the audio and the visuals. And that's the hardest part, finding those first few seconds, the first minute, finding that thread and weaving it through the audio and the visuals. And once you find that thread, you know, you get to that moment where you edit half the film in a day, right? Because you got to find that thread. So you're never going to find that thread from the beginning if you do a rough cut. So that's how I always edited film. So for me to jump to one-to-one, was a piece of cake, and then live stream even easier. I think my 35 years of making films, bred me to be a live streamer for 13 years. And but that's just me.
No, I think that's really great what you said, because it is sort of like, you know, in the art world, it would be akin to sumi-e. You familiar with the Japanese art form of sumi-e?
No.
Japanese brush stroke painting, where you're literally are painting. That's it. You're not going back. You're taking your brush, and you're expressing in the moment what it is that you're seeing, or if it's in your mind, whatever it is that you're painting. If it could be something that's in your mind and you're painting it, or it could be something that you're seeing. But it's just that one. You never go back over it. And so that's what you're talking about, is very similar to the Japanese sumi-e. And they call that soul painting. It's like painting from your soul. And it's your first instinct. It's the first instinct, your first sort of thoughts that come into your mind. It's not even thoughts. It's like, it's just your spirit. It's your spirit speaking. So I think that's an extraordinary, you know, way of approaching filmmaking. And I don't think that, you know, that's not necessarily what a lot of people, the approach that a lot of people, you know, do. So I appreciate that, you know, that approach a lot. I think that, you know, that's something that I would like to do more of too, you know.
And you, yes. that Japanese sumi-e, you just described live stream.
Yeah, I know.
Here's I think it's called Epidemiology, the History of a Word. I sort of came across this by accident 2 years ago because, you know, I love Facebook and I use Google Translate and I have friends from all over the world and I like to Google Translate stuff into different languages and I use Google Translate and I was translating two sentences for a post that had the word live stream and I noticed after the third language I was translating, I'm like, everything translates into that language, but the word live stream, and I go, wait a minute. So I experimented with, like, just for the hell of it, 20 different languages, including Chinese, old and, you know, the traditional and the new, and Korean and Japanese, and it translated everything in, you know, Japanese, Korean, Chinese into their script, except the word live stream was in our alphabet. And every language in Arabic, and it's all live stream, right? That live stream is so new. There is no history of that word in any language. Live stream, I thought yar was the universal word, but live stream certainly is the universal word because live stream in any language is live stream, right?
Yeah.
Take some questions from the live chat.
I was just got distracted for a minute because Fred was just saying some very beautiful things. And he was just saying, Fred at 109 says, I'm in your individual consciousness as you're in mine. And then I said, yes, indeed. And then he said, love stream. Instead of live stream, it's love stream.
That's the rise in Portland.
Yes. And always from the heart in everything. Every time, like the first time, fresh and vital. Yes, always moving forward in a continuous gesture. We do need to move forward in a continuous gesture. So, and in fact, you know, yoga, there's something, are you familiar with yoga? I don't know if you practice.
I don't, but I know a lot of friends that do.
Okay. Well, there's a lot of different styles now that are very popular. I've been practicing since I was really, really young. There's, you know, I sort of do amalgamation of styles in my practice and when I teach too. But one of the styles is Ashtanga Vinyasa. And Vinyasa refers to the flow of things and it's like a dance. So the postures in yoga are called asanas, and asana actually means base, like a base of something. So when you put all the asanas together, it's like you're building your foundation, you know, like it's your foundation. And so but when you're moving from one to the other, you're moving in vinyasa, that's the flow. It's like a dance. So you're moving from one into the other. And when you're in that kind of flow in your life, it's so magical because it's very similar in many different traditions. Because also, I think when you think about acupuncture and acupressure, it's sort of the same thing. It's sort of like, you know, that being in this sort of flow of the meridian, you know, we all have these meridians in our bodies. So using that life force that we have with the meridians inside our bodies together with this flow is when we become unstuck. Because I think that we can become stuck you know, in these different areas of our bodies. And so for me, filmmaking is very much about this movement and integration of these various different wonderful parts of it. Like, you know, the music is such an important part of telling the story. And of course the actors and the story itself, you know, the screenplay and the words that the characters are saying. So all of that, you know, being in this beautiful flow, almost like a dance, like interspersed with each other, is just such a beautiful part of, for me anyway, I just am in love with, always been in love with the medium. My mother was, passed away when I was quite young, and she was, an artist. She was a painter. From a young age, I was very, I was always exposed to the art world. And, you know, both my parents were always bringing me to museums, and we always saw, you know, beautiful works of art. And, it's to be able to use this medium as a canvas, and paint on this canvas with all these beautiful parts that we can put together, is so exciting to me. And so I'm just thrilled. I mean, I'm just really thrilled that at least at this point in time, you know, we are able to, filmmakers like myself are able to make a movie, without spending a gazillion dollars, so that's just really great.
You should do a blog just titled The Seven Chakras of Filmmaking. Take some questions from the live chat.
Okay. Brookside says, cool name, Varushka. Just had to look it up. Varushka is of Russian origin. The meaning of Varushka is foreigner, stranger, traveler from a foreign land. Yes. And actually, Varushka is a Russian variation of Barbara, which means the same thing. It's funny because I always did travel. My name kind of evokes me in a way because I was always traveling with my family because we moved every 2 or 3 years. And I think I was heavily influenced by that. In fact, I don't know if I mentioned this, but my first experience of life or remembering anything about my life was in Japan. My father was posted there as a diplomat. So I actually learned Japanese as well as a 2-year-old can speak Japanese. But I think I was very influenced by learning Japanese at that age, because I think that's why I probably think a little bit differently than maybe other people, you know, from the United States. I mean, I think that when you travel, that's why I encourage parents of young people to travel with their kids, because I think that children's minds are so open and so pliable that they drink in their surroundings, you know. And certainly being exposed to a culture like that at such a young age really, really made me think differently, I think. And so what else? Let's see. Fred109 says, just like human ley lines, meridians of the mandala, circles of light, shaking the chakras. I like your sense of humor, Fred.
Is that different than shaking your booty? Oh!
It sounds like, you know, you can shake your booty and your chakras. Why not?
Then you'd be in a rave.
Yeah, totally. But that's really fun, because in yoga, there's so many, as I said before, I mean, there's so many different styles now that people are familiar with. But really, ultimately, there really is only one yoga. I mean, in that it's really the same thing. You know, it comes from the same source, really. And yoga, actually, the word yoga means union. So it's the union of body, mind, and spirit. And so for me, in a sense, I feel like filmmaking and yoga is very similar, because in the work, for me, in the work, in my work anyway, in film, I do approach it that way, you know, that I'm integrating, you know, body, mind, and spirit into this medium. And I'm also going through this flow, you know, it's like there's this flow of energetic flow with everyone that I'm working with. You know, I'm a great admirer of directors who work a lot with improvisation. You know, like John Cassavetes, whose work was really you know, I guess he could, a lot of people call him the father of independent film. I mean, I think he's had such a huge influence on a lot of independent filmmakers.
Shadows, his first film in 59-60, that changed everything. Shadows. Yeah. John Cassavetes, the actor, folks. John the filmmaker Cassavetes. Part. I love his films.
Me too. And I love the style and the way he arrived at the finished product, you know. And also that what I really love is that he would develop a relationship with his team of people that he then would work with over time. Now, I come from a theater background, and I spent a great deal of time. I trained in Paris and London, but I also spent a great deal of time in Russia. And the Russians, in the Russian theater, you never put on a play in 3 weeks, which is something that's sort of standard here in this country. You know, it's just a 3-week rehearsal period usually, or maybe 4 weeks. But over there, you spend months rehearsing, and the result is so extraordinary. I mean, some of the productions that I've seen in the theater in Moscow are just extraordinary. And there's a sense of an ensemble that I don't see in this country. You know, I think that it's sort of like, just throw this up, you know, like you throw up a play that quickly. It's just, how do you develop the relationships with the characters in 3 weeks? I just don't see how you can do that. So, you know, it's when you're working with a core group of people that you then begin to develop a trust with, really beautiful, beautiful work can come out of that. And that's why Cassavetes was able to create the works that he did, was, aside from the fact that he was just incredibly talented and, you know, had a great mind and had great vision, it was the way that he went about it with his actors. And you can see that. I mean, it's just, you know, it really, really extraordinary.
And he worked, his wife, Gina Rollins, was in it. The Woman Under the Influence, just my most favorite of his films. Peter Falk was part of his ensemble, and a whole, Ben Gazzara was another one. I remember The Killing of a Chinese Bookie.
I mean, I'm sorry, but his films, all of his films are just such masterpieces, you know, and... you know, he didn't really have a budget, like, you know, he really did it for not much money, all those movies, you know, if you think about it. So that's why I'm saying, you know, you don't need to spend a gazillion dollars to make a good film. And of course, there's different kinds of films, you know, I mean, you know, the kinds of films that people, you know, the sort of, you know, large, you know, majority of people are used to, because that's what they see in their regular movie theaters, so the big blockbusters. So they're used to, like, you know, fast paced, you know, high, you know, production, you know, lots of, you know, flashy kind of stuff, you know. So people are used to that. But, you know, what about just a simple story, you know, that with good acting? Though I think those are really important, you know, I think it really, really, really important. To get back to the story, to get back to the simple, you know, the simple part of it, you know what I mean? That instead of being caught up with, like, you know, the flashy car scenes and I mean, you know what I mean. It's no longer really, you know, because sometimes, you know, if you ask somebody after they've seen one of those movies, one of those big Hollywood blockbusters, and you ask them, okay, well, what was the movie about? Or, you know, it's hard for people to tell you really, because it's, and they certainly most of the time, are not really moved. It's more just like, you know, a way to just forget about things for, you know, 90 minutes. You know, it's like they shut down, which is not, I don't think that's really what this medium could be best used for, you know? I think it's a medium that, that's why I loved that so many people answered my question when I asked them if they felt that they had been moved to the point of catharsis with a movie, because I think that that's what this medium is about. I think this medium is about, or can be, you know, about moving people to that point of catharsis. So,
take some more questions from the live chat.
Fred 109 says, Varushka, you've got to make a list of essential movies for us to watch. Love your perspective. Wow. Yes, I can make a list. I can tell you right now of some movies that that moved me greatly, more sort of recent movies in the past 10 years. The Lives of Others, Der Leben der Anderen, which was, again, I think it won the Academy Award for Best Foreign Film.
Oh, excellent. Yeah. German film. Yeah, I love that film. Oh,
my God, I love that film. It's a beautiful film.
How about the East German Stasi? Their CIA and Fellini. Oh, brilliant.
Yeah. And another foreign film that actually was from, I believe, from Colombia, The Secret in Their Eyes, Los Secretos en los Ojos. And I can't remember the name of the director, but are you familiar with that movie?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
I forget the filmmaker's name.
Yes.
That won, I think, an Oscar, certainly an Oscar nod.
I think it did, and I believe it did win for that year too. So, you know, some of these movies, and you know, I really did love Babel, which was made about 5 years ago, I think.
With Brad Pitt, that's in it. The new Mexican new wave exploding with my favorite director out now, Alfonso Cuarón, is part of that Mexican new wave, and
yes,
Guillermo del Toro, who's actually permanently moved to Toronto and is making all his films, but that's Iñárritu, did a Babel. I loved the Mexican new wave. That's, you know, and Cuarón rightly won for Babel, for Gravity last year, the best director.
Yes. So, yeah, I think that there's this wonderful sense of, honoring people from, I just think that there's an explosion of, as you said, the Mexican cinema, but also, some of these other countries as well. I mean, I'm trying to remember. There's been a couple of movies from the Middle East too that I've seen, and I just don't remember the names of them. But I should probably come up with a list, because I'm getting tired. But right now, Fred says my brother does art direction for Guillermo del Toro. Really? Wow, amazing. That is stunning, stunning work. You know, that Guillermo del Toro does,
He was originally a puppeteer and special effects guy down in Mexico. He did Pacific Rim, Pam's Labyrinth, Hellboy 1 and 2. He's got a legendary comic book and graphic novel collection of 30,000. Like in his home in Mexico City, it was so many, he had to buy a second home just to house all his comic and graphic novels. And when he permanently, 2-3 years ago, permanently said that's it, he shot in Toronto three times. He moved his whole family to Toronto. He's shooting all his films from now till when he dies there, and he's got a close relationship with TIFF, because TIFF is the road to the Oscars. That's how you do it, and nowadays. And he bought four mansions on Millionaire's Row in the Beaches area. One for his comic and graphic novels, right? One for his family, of course. One for his cinematographer, Novato. He won the Oscar, his DP, for Pam's Labyrinth. And the fourth, just for friends and actors and whoever. That's the type of, he's a funny guy. He's an amazing.
Wow. Yeah, that sounds like fun. I think that's hysterical, actually, you know, to put all these graphic novels in one place like that.
Eccentric filmmaker.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's a lot of, you know, some of the more interesting filmmakers who've been eccentric. You know, Fellini didn't give interviews. And actually, I know somebody that actually did an interview with him, one of those rare, you know, things. And do you know what he said? I don't know if you really know about this, but he said that what he used to do is he used to give the people that, you know, he would go to money to get money from, he would actually give them a fake script. and then he would get the money and he would do something completely different.
I remember Fellini stopped. He wrote all his scripts from, I think he started this process from 59-60. All his script was based on his dreams. He had the easiest writing schedule of any filmmaker. What he did, at first he just had a notepad, but he'd write the first 20 minutes that he woke up, right? And then he found that that was tedious, so he got a tape recorder. So the vast majority, every single dream he had, every single day, he'd always like put the quarter inch fresh tape at night. Sometimes he'd wake up and it'd be like, what? It's done? Because he'd wake up in a nightmare, say that, and go back to sleep. Then he'd file it away in a hoodoo voodoo way. So if he was doing Satyricon or Rome or whatever, Roma, he'd base all his scenes out of his dreams. Every Satyricon is the ultimate example of this. And then fast forward to Casanova with Canadian actor Donald Sutherland. Donald Sutherland talks about, I heard an interview with him about the first day of shooting. This is the funniest shooting I've ever seen. Okay, so picture this. It's Cinecittà, the big studios in Rome. Day one, they're shooting Casanova. It's one of those, he's in the boat with all that waving plastic, right? And and he notices when he walks in, and that's the scene. So Donald Sutherland says, I walk in and there's a cafe scene, and he's like, well, wait a minute, I see the schedule for today, there's no cafe scene. And what it is, Fellini invites all his friends on set and sets up a cafe scene, full-blown, whatever they want, chatting it up. It's like psychotic. They're talking really loud. And so, okay, first shot, you know, of the whole film, he's in the boat, and Donald Sutherland's doing this, and scene one, take one of the whole film. 10 seconds into the shot, Fellini yells, cut, cut, cut. And Donald Sutherland thought he did something wrong and Fellini would approach him. No, Fellini walks over to his friends in the cafe scene and goes, what are you guys doing? Maestro, you guys are shooting and what's going on? He goes, no, you don't worry. We're not going to use this audio. You're here for atmosphere. It's very important. No, don't stop. If we're shooting, don't stop. And so, okay. So Donald Sutherland's like dumbfounded. It's Fellini, okay. Take two, action. And then Donald Sutherland says, this is the only time in my life I've ever done this. 10 seconds into it, I couldn't even think. And I yelled, cut. As an actor, you don't yell, cut. I yelled, cut. Talk to Fellini and says, Fellini, I can't fucking think here. Like, it's incredible. I forgot my lines. It's like, he goes, you forgot your lines. He goes, okay, I'll tell you what. For the rest of this film, forget about your lines. This is how you're going to do it. You're not going to even speak your lines. I'm not even going to give you the script. I'll tell you what the shot is. This is what you're going to say here, because we're all going to dub it. You're going to tell me numbers. So you're going to say 5, 38, 41. Don't forget the 58 and 79 and 30. And so all his lines in Casanova on set were numbers. And he says it was the most insane. But that's a typical Fellini film. I love Fellini.
I love that. That's a great story. That is just awesome. So, yeah, there you have it, you know? I mean, and somehow, you know, through all the chaotic madness, the way that his mind works, he made these masterpieces, you know? So I'm just sad that he never got to make the Castaneda. You know about the Castaneda thing, right?
No.
Well, he was he wanted to make you know about Carlos Castaneda's book, The Teachings of Don Juan, and yeah. You know, that whole series. Well, he wanted to make Fellini approached him approached Castaneda about this, and Castaneda turned him down. Said no. You know, I think that's such a shame. I think it would have been amazing for him to have made that movie, you know? I know this because my friend who interviewed him spoke to him about this. Yeah. So, you know, maybe one day somebody will make that series a la Fellini.
A la Fellini is right.
Yeah. You know, that would be interesting, wouldn't it, to be making a movie like, you know, as though you were Fellini, like of something that he would have done. I don't know. You know.
Oh, that would be great.
Yeah, you know, but my goodness, it's late.
We're almost approaching the 4.5 hour mark.
Am I allowed to go, you know, go to sleep?
It's up to you. It's up to you. Yes. If you want to take some final questions and then wrap it up.
Yeah, I need to wrap it up because I've got to get up early in the morning and I still have a bunch of things to do. So. If anybody has any other questions or, you know, comments or, you know, anything from anywhere, let me know.
Again, I'm going to upload this to YouTube after this and then I'll send you a tweet about that link. So feel free to put it on the Kickstarter page and stuff. I guess at this point, we'll just final comments from you, Varushka Franceschi, filmmaker working on a dramatic feature film on fracking called A Crack in Everything. And do go to the Kickstarter funding page.
Yes, please. So I'm just going to, wait, I'm just going to say something here on the thing. I urge everyone who's watching this to go to our Kickstarter. We only have, actually now it's really like 3.5 days left of this campaign. And I've worked so hard to get to this point. So I really need the help of individual people, even if people could just throw in $1 or $5, every little bit counts. So, we have a little ways to go before Sunday. So the link is, I can put the link back up, but it's also a website. You can actually also go to my website too, which is www.crackineverything.com. And at the bottom of the website is a link to the Kickstarter. And you can also follow me on Facebook. You can find me on Facebook under Varushka Franceschi. I also have a Crack in Everything Facebook page. And on that Facebook page, so far we have about 3,000 followers, but we also we post, you know, updates about the movie, but we also post about what's going on in the world of fracking, climate change, renewables. So it's pretty informative. We post quite a bit every day. We also post memes as well, that can be shared. And I can be followed on Twitter at Shapeshift Dream. And I'm very, very, very thrilled and excited to be on this journey. And so if anybody has any other questions or comments or anything before I sign off, because I must get some sleep, some beauty sleep, and also some functioning sleep so I can be able to function tomorrow, let me know if you have any other questions.
Well, I you do have to do a bunch of things, and there's only one of you, as we've talked enough times. I know how you feel. I wish there was three or four of me.
I know. It would be fun, too. But, yes. Yeah, that's good. Fred is posting all the links on the chat. So I wish, you know, I could keep talking with you for a long time. And I think that, you know, certainly would have loved to talk more about Fellini in particular, because I'm a huge fan of Fellini. But maybe we'll just have to do this again. So.
Well, absolutely. We will. I mean, we got to talk about live stream and stuff. And if you want to start live streaming, I could totally train you. No problem.
Yes, it would be very fun. So I just read something that Rise PDX said. It says, first time stream for her, and she's already in a 5-hour. We can't even call them interviews.
I still do.
Yeah, and then Rise says, yeah, interview sounds CIA-ish. And Fred says, experiences are more like it.
We'll come up with a term. Yeah. But for now, they're interviews.
Okay. Yeah.
A collective interview.
Or you could just say it's just the experience, you know? Come be with the experience.
Yarr.
Mind melds. Yeah, Banksy on toast. Mind melds. That's a good one.
Banksy's from Florida. Fred's from Toronto. Rise is from Portland.
Yeah. And Rise PDX reminds that my mission statement, one of my mission statements, and certainly on my Twitter, is using creative arts to shapeshift dreams into the tangible. So yes, that's me. So boy, this was fun. Thank you for having me on this live stream event, this live stream experience, this live stream collaboration. This love stream collaboration.
Rise is the first one that started coming up with that. They got a Portland love stream channel.
Yeah, that's so cool. Love that. And and thank you, you know, for doing what you're doing. It's really, really wonderful.
Here's a thought for your watch a chick make a flick.com. Instead of like having a regular live stream show, you can have a regular love stream show.
Yeah. Love stream. The chick stream. Something like that. So sounds good.
Alrighty. And, so thank you, Varushka Franceschi. That's an Italian last name. Yarr, you got some Italian roots as well.
Oh, yes. Very Italian, probably more Italian than anything else. From Tuscany. So La Toscana.
Hey, wayo, now we dance. Okay, well, thank you so much there, Varushka Franceschi, whose new film that she's in pre-production and is crowdsourcing. So do support your indie filmmaker. And thank you for being on. And officially, it's now 4.5 hours.
Yes. And I'm about to pass out. So Thank you, though, and have a beautiful night. What time is it? Is it the same time as the East Coast?
We're 1 hour ahead. It's 12:40 here.
12:40? Wow. Okay.
So okay. I'll upload this to YouTube, and I'll post it on Facebook and Twitter, and feel free to share that link and put it on Kickstarter and on all the other pages. Because I think as well as a filmmaker to filmmaker discussion, which more than anything, that's what this was, that, you know, now a lot of these people, you know, you're not faceless in a sense, that, you know, I think people really got to know where you're at and why they should support this film.
I appreciate that. And I really do. And it's really great to get to know you guys. And branch out, because, you know, sometimes, as you probably know, you know, when you're in this, I was in this research mode, and I was sort of kind of a hermit for so long that I love this part of it too, of like, you know, reaching out and you know, connecting with people, and connecting with people in Canada is great. I love Canada, by the way. So and what Fred says. Dream beautifully and sleep serenely. And Sundave 22 says, come back soon. And Fred 19 says, do it again soon, please. So I will, all of those things. And I will definitely dream beautifully and sleep serenely. And I hope you guys do too.
That's Sundave from Santa Rosa, California, just outside of San Fran. Okay, and thank you, Varushka.
Okay, all right. Bye.
Yarrrrrr. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Yarr. Thank you, folks. And yarr. It didn't freeze. Thank you so much to our guest, Varushka Franceschi, whose new film, Cracking Everything. My name is Dee Shanger. I'm a mod and live stream director here at Occupy Toronto since day one. Exactly 3 years ago. Occupy D-Day was always October 15th. That's when the explosion worldwide happened. And it certainly changed my life. I think, like a lot of people, they were holding their breath previous to September, October 15th, and it was a dream come true to a lot of people, and the Occupy Toronto live stream was really kicking it, and I remember just that first day, all the thousands of viewers that they had, and when I wasn't at the rally and march at King and Bay at 10 a.m. I was actually watching the live stream because I was too good to be true, so to speak. I think for a lot of people it was. And when I followed the live stream. It was amazing. There was thousands of viewers. And then I went down to St. James Park. I think it was around 1 o'clock and stuff. And had a lot of friends there and got the tour of St. James Park. And the media tent was just rocking it. There was at least a couple dozen people. You had the live stream department, the Twitter twins, you know, Facebook, the website, and all the media there, the tech people. It was going on, but the live stream was down. And I'm like, there's still like 700 people watching the live stream and you're down? Like, I mean, let's start the dialogue. And they sort of went on, it sort of didn't. And I started planting the seed, well, we should go 24/7, really, because that's the way you counter mainstream media, which was very negative, reported very negative about day one of Occupy. And we ended up occupying for 40 days and 40 nights. And it took 5 days, because it was a collective, of to finally go 24/7, and we went 24/7 for 40 days and 40 nights, because we continued for 5 days after we were evicted. And I know we had done a few experiments, because people weren't sure how we can fill that 24/7. I had tons of ways to do it. I mean, we got a few thousand people that come here during the day. There's no shortage of people to interview, and there's enough rallies and marches. And so we talked about it. It took 5 days. And I remember on the Monday, they did an experiment where, okay, we'll do like an open mic type thing. We'll set up the laptop there and anyone can just come on. We won't monitor it. People could just, and we'll be outside the tent and tell people to come in and say what you want. And, but no one was watching the, what people were saying. And actually it turned out that it turned out a troll fest. People were saying racist, sexist. It was, yeah, I think they put a stop to it after the 2 or 3 hour mark, that no, that's not the way to go. But it was an experiment, right? So we kept talking through it And it was, I think, around 5:45 p.m. That we went live 24/7. And being the one with the most experience and everything, I think I directed about 80-85% of all that 40 days and 40 nights. I look at it as the longest film ever made, 40 days and 40 nights. And I'm sorry, I'm blind here. I can't see the live chat. My browser's frozen, and for some reason on Procaster, the live chat's not showing up there. But I'm just wrapping it up on the third anniversary of Occupy D-Day. And we call it as such that even though Occupy Wall Street, and shout out to its live streaming mothership and our sister ship, Global Revolution, for restreaming almost everything that we do, including this, that it started Occupy Wall Street September 17th, 2011. And really, mostly in the States, there was at least a couple dozen, maybe 30 tops, the morning of Saturday, October 15th, 2011. But by the end of that day, there was over 1,000. It exploded worldwide. So we call that Occupy D-Day. And this is the third anniversary today, October 15th, 2014, for the Deep Archives. Yeah, and really by our heyday of really November 1st, there was 6,000 Occupy places and large municipalities. Now, folks, like, Occupy is the greatest and most instantaneous worldwide movement. Remember in 2011, the Time magazine, The Protester, because it started with the Arab Spring, the European Summer, and the Occupy Fall. Yeah, it was huge. It was massive. And of those 6,000, there was about 500 to 600 live stream channels. I would say that 90% of them were one-offs that no one really knew, and everyone's doing it. So, hey, you got a laptop, you do it. And there was no training. And so 90% of it was. I'd say there was about 80 to 90 live stream, Occupy live stream channels that broadcast, like, you know, at least two or more times. There was maybe, I would say, about 20 or so that broadcast on a daily basis. There was only 4 that broadcast double-digit hours every day. There was Den Haag, The Hague, in the Netherlands, and there was Germany, Occupy Berlin, Occupy Germany. They did about 12 to 14 hours. And then second was Global Rev. Global Rev, Occupy Wall Street's live stream mothership, they would, I would say, a good 18 hours to 20 hours a day. And there was only one that live streamed 24/7. That was Occupy Toronto, the one that you're watching here. Yeah, we had a motto, you know, because mainstream media was no friend of ours, that, you know, mainstream media is reporting yesterday's news about us. If you hear any shit or any rumors about us, well, just come on the live chat, you know. And what we also found is people's introduction to Occupy and coming down and actually occupying was, I would say, a good 75-80% of it was through the live streams. Because, like I was saying, for me, you know, it's like, you'd think, you know, it was too good to believe. And all of a sudden, you know, you watch the live stream and you're hooked because you're hearing stuff that you never heard or stuff that was in your heart. And so it was a huge organizing tool, the live stream, and going 24/7 because you have a worldwide audience, right? People were following us, you know, in 24 time zones, and we live streamers always think in 24 time zones. And it was absolutely astounding. Everything of St. James Park, and I'm still here, you know, Fred 109, Lady Zaga, they were all there, you know, a lot of people, and a lot of people have come and gone on the live stream team, certainly, or, you know, certainly the number one most underreported story of Occupy is really the hyperspeed rise of grassroots media. That yes, there was the civilian journalist before Occupy, but man, it totally gelled. And the use of social media was astounding. But the sword and shield of Occupy was always the live stream. The shield part, because cops are scared of live, right? Especially to a worldwide audience on, you know, six continents. And it keeps them at bay. It protects people on the ground. I know there was a couple times in the first 5 days where, I mean, we might not have been lived in the first 5 days, but we were ready to go, that the cops tried to swoop in twice. The live stream was on them and they ran with their tail between their legs and they never tried it again, right? So it really protects people on the ground in terms of the shield part. In terms of the sword and the way Occupy model of using social media is the way it's done today, was that if you have a march and rally, well, where are you going to tweet, Facebook, email, blog, you know, website people to, but the live stream? Because why? Because of all our senses. Seeing represents the ultimate truth. And you're talking to a proud occupier here, and it's great to see a resurgence of Occupy. We're the last Occupy live stream with the actual word Occupy in it. We're quite proud of that. And but to see that what's going on in Hong Kong, it's called in Hong Kong, you know what they call it? Occupy Central. It was a professor in Hong Kong that came up with that name. The full name is Occupy Central with Love and Peace. The hashtag Occupy Central. That's what they call it in Hong Kong. But the foreign media have dubbed it the Umbrella Revolution for the way in the early days they used umbrellas to deflect all the pepper spray that and mace that the police were using against them. And it's great to see in St. Louis and Ferguson, Occupy SLU, St. Louis University, and there's an Occupy camp going on there. I think it's really, really amazing resurgence. Now, yes, Occupy in itself is a shadow of its former self 3 years later, but it's morphed into so many different entities because that model of how to occupy, how to use social media, how to use live stream, that's why we Occupy live streamers are always the most leading edge of the whole live stream world, really expounding the theory, the art, the science. We have fueled so much development, mostly on this end. I always go on and on about we need more interactivity. We need to pipe you in, audio and video, in addition to the text that you're doing, and more archival practices. That's what we do here and stuff. But it's morphed into so many entities. I'll give you an example. The Quebec student movement of 2012, from February to September of 2012. Well, they were all trained, you know, in October, November 2011 at Occupy Montreal and Quebec City more than anything, right? I don't know more morphed out of, I don't know more started at the end of October 2012. And by the way, we're going to have one of the co-founders, Sheila McAdam, on Friday, because this is Kopit Lodges Fracking Show. And October 17th is the nasty, nasty first anniversary of the nasty RCMP raid, helping out the fracking company SWIN. They used 500 to 800 RCMP officers to, they used pepper spray and attack dogs, rubber bullets, helicopters, drones, planes. And so they're not celebrating this Friday, and we're going to be live all day this Friday, by the way, that anniversary, they're honoring the people who stood in the front lines. So we're going to have all kinds of programming. We'll be coming on around noon or so, Eastern Standard Time, and we'll be going till quite late. It'll be a marathon, 12-hour at least, and there's a lot of scheduled speakers. We're going to be Skyping in a lot of people, one of which is Sylvia McAdam. So that's one of the things that morphed into out of Occupy and so many other entities, and we still got it going on as far as we're concerned, because we're doing a lot of good. And I know that a lot of us old timers in Occupy, and like, wow, 3 years and we're old timers, we're helping out in a big way the live streamers in Ferguson, which have an infestation of trolls. You know, to see all the couple dozen streamers and all the new live streaming channels coming out of Ferguson, and really, as far as I could see, the only one with an actual discussion like what you experienced tonight on our live chat, and a beautiful ebb and flow between what's happening here and what's happening on the live chat, is really Bella Eichel. And everyone else has huge infestations of paid police trolls and other regular trolls that they've had to shut off the live chat. That is wow. And it was great that Vlad, you know, from Occupy Wall Street, you know, was down there this week. Glad to see Tim Poole, Luke Rudowski, We Are Change, you know, and a lot of the seasoned pros. And yeah, absolutely astounding. And it was absolutely amazing. So, and also as well, stay tuned. We're going to have a lot of extensive interviews. Oh, hold on. We just lost internet connection if you're watching this in the archives. Hold on, I'm just waiting. I'm going to hold that thought for a second. While we're connecting, I'm just looking at the diagnostics if you're watching this in the archives. And I'm just about to wrap it up. Okay, and we are back. So as I was saying, stay tuned as well. We have been in contact with a lot of the live streamers. We're trying to figure out a schedule. I know we've talked about this, but we're going to be interviewing extensively Bella and Reb. We've already interviewed Reb, but we're going to continue to Reb and Basem and a whole bunch of other live streamers. With all things considering, you know, we're just working out a schedule, and we're going to do a lot more detailed discussions with the live streamers, because I think it's important to put those live streamers on a pedestal. And I think for a lot of the viewers that are watching those live streams, you know, there's not much of a discussion on the live chat. So to put them in an environment of here, us interviewing them at Occupy Toronto, and that their true followers can actually ask questions, bring on the trolls. We eat trolls for breakfast here. And so stay tuned for that. That's in the works as we speak. And it's going to be as many of them that want to come on, and it's not just once, but we're going to sustain that. And we'll interview Varushka, who's been on tonight as well. Everyone's always invited to come back. And and unfortunately, again, I repeat, for the last 3 hours and 18 minutes, I've been blind on the live chat, where I can't read the live chat on Procaster, and my browser's frozen. I can't restart the computer because we're in the middle of the show. Sorry that but Varushka was able to take your questions and stuff. So, folks. As we live streamers never ever, we always end this way. You know, as we live streamers never ever say bye, but rather peace out and see you on the live chat, because we will. Okay, well, thank you so much for tuning in, and yar yar and yar and yar. Dee Shanger out. And remember, Friday at high noon till midnight at least, we're going to be live streaming all day from beautiful downtown Elsabuktug First Nations in New Brunswick on the east coast of Canada. And Yarr. Okay, so thank you, folks, for tuning in. And peace out and see you on the live chat. Yarr.